Good evening, party people, and welcome back to the Bar with an X after a week-long hiatus. My name is Cameron. It's good to see you again. I'll be your bartender this evening, or I guess tasting instructor, or like narrator, or storyteller, or whatever you have it. Not really making any cocktails this evening. Instead, we just got back from a really fun trip, Anna and I just have a lot to share. So we're here sharing three things on our little spirits road trip journey, which I will walk you all through. It's been a while. How is everybody? I hope y'all are doing well. Some of you out there, we've seen each other recently. And if you want to put a hand up, there is no pressure to do so. This is my hand up with you. It's so good to see you. And we will be recollecting. You might, maybe there'll be some cameo appearances, cameo suggestions of whatever, of the people that we visited. Who really knows? I don't really know. I see eye faces from our friend Annie out there. Maybe. Hi there. Hi there, everybody. So to give a little context, so last week you might have noticed that we didn't stream. There was no stream that happened. There was a small little 5-minute thing because apparently the Twitch app hates me, but we last streamed 2 weeks ago with a melon stream in preparation. Oh, actually, no, it was a board game stream in preparation for Anna and my trip, a little vacation. It just so happens that the family vacation this year happened to coincide with a trip to the Gen Con board game convention this year, and so we had the wonderful idea of just doing a total freaking road trip in the path that you see before you here, which I hope is not super duper cut off by this microphone over here. I'm gonna kind of take this opportunity to just kind of walk you through our trip, because it wasn't just driving, it wasn't just lounging, relaxing, we actually kept ourselves very, very busy. I think the people who probably know that have the most context about this journey were the people who follow the Instagram page, where I was just posting stories multiple different times a day of different distilleries that we were going to, different experiences that we were getting ourselves into, different pieces of our journey and stuff. It was a really, really fun time, and I would say overall that it was probably one of the best vacations that I have ever had, and that's thanks in part by Anna and her amazing planning abilities to pick out stops in between and these awesome locales, and in general my family for being there and having a vacation set up every single year, and all the people who are so passionate about a particular thing that they make a convention for it, and the people who allowed us to stay with them. There are multiple different parts of the journey said there. I will go through more or less each of them, and we'll start from there. I see Annie saying it was the triangle of the vacation. We did move in a triangular fashion. So the journey went a little something like this, and I'm going to zoom in with my remote, which is somewhere in the midst of all the stuff that I have on my bar over here. So let's do a little run through of where the heck we found ourselves on our little vacation. I'll zoom you guys in just a little bit over here. I hope nothing's being blocked and stuff. It looks like one of the islands might be. So let me move this a little this way so we can get a better view there. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to a little explanation of what my vacation was. I'm gonna go on this side, so I'm a little closer to the microphone and stuff. So our little triangle of vacation, our little road trip, started off naturally right here at the Bar with an X, which, despite the fact that it exists fictitiously online, it does actually have a physical location, because that's with an X Studios is located here in just about Philadelphia, somewhere in Pennsylvania over here. I'm completely blocking that. This is why I had the dowel of discipline here. Suddenly geography. That and, it reminded me of the fact that we have this little, you know, we have this little map of the United States. I don't know, that kind of maps up all in a certain way. It's great. And I just whacked my funny bone on my freezer, so I can feel the buzziness in my hand. So naturally, there's a little bit of context here of various other trips that I've taken throughout the last couple of weeks or so. I'm gonna get down here because it's not really important to the conversation just yet. Hi there, it's really close this time around. So there are a couple of different states that I picked up bottles from. This kind of idea, all the bottles that you see over here, whether it be this guy or whether it be this guy or all the other stuff, we'll get through all of them. I had this a little bit of fascination of trying to get a spirit from every single state that we wind up stopping in. And it kind of started with, naturally, my hometown of New Jersey. There's some bottles that you can only pick up there, some local favorites and some old, some new ones as well. There is places that my family actually lives. One of my family members lives up in Vermont. Some of my family live over in New York, and family travels and whatnot everywhere else. So I kind of developed this habit of trying to taste the local area, which, as we kind of went through our journey a little bit, as I continued to drop that phrase to various different people along our journey, seemed to be a rather common thing. They're apparently, I'm not the only person who likes to go to a certain location and taste the food of the area, the drink of the area, the terroir of the ground and whatnot, as some wine lovers might be familiar with that particular term. And so the precursor to the trip that we took last week, there are a couple of states that, although not necessarily a part of the journey, are a part of this little recollection here, at least so in part. Those particular locations will be, I did not visit Vermont these past week. That's up here. Oh, you actually can't see that. Hold up a second. Vermont. It's up here. It's in the northern part, over there. Passing through Connecticut, Massachusetts, and Rhode Island, and all the other places and stuff. The bottle that I have from there, I don't think I've actually brought on stream before, but it is this bottle of maple-infused whiskey that I picked up near my brother's place. Smuggler's Notch, it's called. I think that might be a good place to start. In addition, actually, I'll kind of wrap these two things all together. The other place that we didn't exactly visit during this trip, it was actually a different trip for something completely different, is we went down south. This is the little green areas that I have on my board here. We went to technically New Jersey. I didn't go back to New Jersey. I didn't visit my parents there. I visited them down south. Skunktown Distillery, back in my hometown of Flemington, New Jersey. And farther down here, we have the beaches of OBX, which I keep thinking is in North Carolina. Is it North Carolina? Maybe it's not. I don't remember where OBX is supposed to be. Alexa, where is the Outer Banks? What state? Alexa, what state are the Outer Banks in? North Carolina. So I definitely drew that incorrectly. That's all right. We're going to fix that right here. That's why it's the beauty of this stuff. The Outer Banks is somewhere down here. There we go. I'm fixing it live. That's kind of where we went. Let's just imagine for a moment that I completely drew our car over the water and stuff. There we go. That's the little piece of geography. We went around to the Outer Banks and tried to purchase bottles from the area. There was no particular distilleries that I could find down there. However, along the way, we did pass through Cape Charles, Virginia. That's why I had the star there, duh. And Cape Charles Distillery in Virginia has a vodka called the Woo Woo Vodka, which we did give, that we did stop by and stuff. So let's start from there, right? Let me take our angle back out again. You know, I don't often use this little zooming effect here. Sometimes it can be a little disruptive, but alas, here we are. So describing the first leg of our journey is going to be this first part of the journey before the journey, where the whole bottle exploration stuff kind of started. And to put things quite simply, I have family that live elsewhere and we've taken trips every once in a while, and I just like to pick up bottles from the area. So that's kind of what inspired that. In particular, something from my hometown. We'll start with that. One of the things for a friend of ours, a friend of mine from back home, who comes up every once in a while for cocktails and stuff, graciously gave us the taste of our hometown from this place called Skunktown Distillery, which I want to say the back of the bottle may confirm is in Flemington, New Jersey, perhaps, or at least somewhere along the area. Ah, it says. There's a lot of history on the back of the bottle, so let's go into it. Skunktown Distillery, which for some reason prints blue text on the back of a black background, making it very, very difficult to see, but my eyes are wonderful and I will recollect it for you. Hand-peeled potatoes, tomato paste, lemon juice, the simplest of ingredients, all locally sourced, create a smooth vodka with a mildly earthy finish. This is vodka you will enjoy neat and blends into all mixed drinks. It is a potato, tomato paste, and lemon juice vodka, oddly enough. I thought this was just potato. So I'm learning a little bit of something right off the bat with everybody else. Skunktown Distillery is the pride and joy of two friends who decided to chase the American dream and bootstrap their way into the world of legal craft distilling. Legal, specifically, not the illegal stuff, naturally. Every step of each bottle has hands-on attention to ensure we create spirits worthy of sharing with your friends and loved ones. We select locally grown, non-GMO, and/or organic ingredients and use eco-conscious methods in our distillery. From raw materials to finished product, we highlight the beautiful culture of rural New Jersey, steeped in history as old as our country, where one small village started out with the name Skunktown. Exactly what that village is I'm guessing Flemington. I want to say it's in Flemington, New Jersey. I could be wrong about that. Any of the local Jerseyans out there who want to correct me on that, please do so. I love swift corrections or corrections that come after the fact, such as in, like, you know, the comments of videos and stuff afterwards. Actually, one of the really cool things about the whole Instagram storying thing is I got the chance to talk to a lot of people along the way, based on the distilleries that we went to, the people we met along the way. And it was an absolute pleasure. And if you're catching any of this stuff now, I just want to reiterate that it was a pleasure to make your acquaintance, and it was a lot of fun. It really accentuated the journey and really made me feel like, man, I'd love to do something like that again. But let's get a little taste of New Jersey, a little taste of Skunktown, New Jersey. I'm gonna grab myself, I have my snifter glasses over here. I don't really know whether or not that's going to be I only have two snifter glasses, so I don't know whether or not the plan to go with this stuff, but it's a little bit of vodka. I don't know if we need too much sniftiness there. Maybe, I don't know. I have plenty of tiny little glasses, so I'm just gonna go with these. I got shot glasses and stuff, so that's what we're gonna start out with, this little thing of Skunktown vodka, which has had multiple occasions here at the Bar of the Next before. Anna is personally a big fan of Skunktown vodka. She likes the way that it tastes. She finds it smoother than Tito's, which I have a little bit left for. We could do a little bit of a comparison, but there are a lot of other bottles making an appearance this evening, and I don't really feel like going through all of these. It's very, there's so much stuff here. I don't know, we'll see how things go, whether we'll get through all of them, but I will assure you that there will be pieces of content created aside from just this little Twitch channel here that will go over everything that we found along our journey. I have taken a lot of research onto content creation and recording and stuff like that. So all the distilleries we went to, we've got some footage from, I've got tasting notes on them, whatnot. And I'm hoping that throughout the course of this next week, the blog that we have on the Discord and the vlogs that will come out on TikTok and Instagram will reflect all the nuanced details of the trip that we took. I am, alas, only one person. So in case I miss a couple of things, we are only human here. I see Annie saying, blind taste test to see if Anna can identify them? Maybe. She says she's doing her studying and stuff. She's taking a chill pill today. So if she comes up, it'll be a treat for all of us. So this is our Skunktown vodka from Skunktown Distillery in Skunktown, New Jersey, Flemington or otherwise. I have been told, I've had this vodka before, and I find that it is a little less chemically. It is very smooth, and it's got that certain earthy tone to it that I think comes from the potatoes. Although, you know, this will be my fresh palate sip, so we'll see if that still withstands the taste test here. Now, for anybody who's trying to get into spirit tasting and stuff, I am not necessarily an authority on it, but I've been trying my hand at a little bit more of these past couple months or so I have a little bit of tips for anybody who's just trying to get into it. My first tip would be, just take small sips. You don't need a big old gulp of vodka or a big old gulp of bottled and bond rye or bourbon if you're just starting out. You can take your time with it. You might need to work your way up. You could start off with smaller proof spirits, things that are a little more sweeter, like liqueurs and stuff like that, or even just try to taste like beers or wines and stuff and work your way up to the spirits level. I jumped right in, and I kind of, you know, it's a steep learning curve, so I'm sure I had a little bit of a negativity from that in terms of kind of, it's whatever the opposite of cold turkey is. It's not cold turkey where you're taking something away, you're just like jumping head first into it. Whatever that was. But that's because I've been doing cocktail mixology for a number of years now, and the spirit tasting aspect of it is something that I really, really felt passionate to try to get into, especially as we were visiting distilleries who, you know, you could buy cocktails and stuff, but flights were notably cheaper. I did not have a flight of any Skunktown stuff, but I know they also do rums, they also do whiskeys and stuff. This is just the one that we have regularly stocked here because Anna likes it so much. It is really, really nice. It's not as, like, despite the fact that vodka is a very neutral spirit, it's kind of like sipping water in the sense that there are different tastes to different types of water if you key in close enough to it. Like, I can compare my tap water to my filtered water that I get from the Brita filter, as well as water that I get from, like, those little Fiji water containers. And although I don't have the vocabulary to describe exactly how one tastes compared to another, I can say with absolute certainty that they do taste different in a way. Just like I can tell that this vodka tastes different from other ones. To me, some vodkas, some very cheap vodkas, like, I don't know, where's the cheap vodka that I have around here? No, they're in the back. They're in my closet over there. All the cheap vodkas are there for infusions and stuff, so I'm not going to bother with it. There's too many spirits this evening. But sometimes they can be almost chemical tasting, as if there's something that's like, when I think of like acidic chemical reactions or like something like a pharmaceutical or like, have you ever taken a pill, right? And you put it on your tongue, some pills have a very like odd, like bitter metallic taste to them. I find some vodkas can taste like that. This in particular, not at all. I am getting those notes of like, it's almost like a zesty lemon from the, I guess, the lemon juice that they use in there. I'm getting almost this earthy taste to it that's almost a little sweet in my opinion. I did just brush my teeth like an hour or so ago, so there might be a little bit of that residual mint still hanging in my mouth and stuff, but it pairs so well with that. It's not like there's an unpleasant aftertaste too. This is a very nice, clean, and like just very, very bright vodka. It sticks around in a very, very pleasant way. And that's something I think that Anna really, really likes about it. Now, there will be another vodka that we'll taste later on. It's interesting to think about vodka in terms of just what kind of spirit it is. It's neutral. It's not really supposed to have flavor and stuff. And so vodka can be made by distilling things a number of times until all of the color, most of the flavor and stuff has been distilled right out of it. The exact number of times that Skunktown has been distilled, I'm not exactly sure. The exact number of, let's say, Tito's is, I believe, 5 or 6. And I can double check that actually, because somebody did make a comparison about it to compare to one of the other vodkas that we found there. So Tito's vodka is distilled how many times? It says 6 times. And one of the bottles that we get to afterwards, which I guess I'll do that now because we're on the vodka train, so we'll just go with that, is this woo-woo vodka from Cape Charles Distillery. So Cape Charles Distillery was a part of our journey. We went to a friend's wedding, and we were able to stop a little bit along the way in this place called Cape Charles, Virginia. And it was a small little like port kind of touristy town, which was really, really cute to stop in. Allow me to get the bucket for a second, because I do not plan on sipping every single spirit that we cover this evening. It would be wild. Actually, the first distillery that we went to was this Cape Charles Distillery in Virginia as we were making our way down to North Carolina in the Outer Banks. And that was, I think that was the first like spirit flight that I had done at a distillery in particular. So I was like, oh boy, there were 4 different things that we tried. There was a rye whiskey, there was a bourbon whiskey, there was a vodka, and there was a gin. They were all pretty good. I will say that out of the 4, my favorite was the rye whiskey. I have tasting notes about it somewhere, but there was a flavor that just stuck around in my mind for like a week afterwards. And I will admit, I regret not buying the bottle. Excuse me. We bought the Woo Woo because that was the one that Anna really liked. But the Woo Woo vodka, if I recall correctly, is handcrafted small batch vodka capturing the spirit of the Eastern Shore of Virginia in every single bottle. Not a lot of info about it. But I do recall that our waitress was saying that the Woo Woo vodka is distilled 9 times as opposed to Tito's is 6 times. She had described it as smoother than Tito's, less chemical than Tito's, and so that's kind of what I pass on to you guys. I do have some tasting notes on it, but it was in video form, so I can't quite distill that down for now. It would just take me too long. So this is the fresh bottle, and I'm gonna open it up to taste it with all the rest of y'all. This is Woo Woo vodka. Exactly where the term woo woo comes from in this case, I'm honestly not so sure, and I really wish I would have asked about it while we were there. Perhaps our friends at Cape Charles Distillery will be able to answer that question if we pose it to them. If anybody's really curious about it, I would be happy to ask. It is a fresh bottle. It has just been freshly unwrapped, and here comes that cork sound, which I absolutely love. It's the best part about opening up bottles. It's that little sound. We'll take my Skunktown. I'll put it off to the side. Like that. This was our New Jersey spirit. I would like to also give a great shout out to New Jersey because your liquor logistics are much better than Pennsylvania's. I can get a bunch of spirits out in Jersey that I just can't get around here, which I'm thankful for. I also thank the state of New Jersey for being the place of my birth, because without New Jersey there, if I were born in the same place, I don't really know what kind of void I would have been born in, if you were born in the void, that is. If anybody else has been born in the void, let me know. I'm curious. I want to know about your experience. So we got our woo-woo vodka here. Compared to the Skunktown, I would say it looks like the same color. It was definitely not any more or less viscous. I'm just trying to pick things to describe. A little more isopropyl, if I had to describe it on the nose. It smells a little bit more like hand sanitizer than the Skunktown vodka did. Not as earthy. A little more green. A little more chemical. A little, it's like pointy in a way. It's like a pointed vodka. This, to me, and this is not in a negative way, tastes a little bit closer to some of the more chemical cheap vodkas that I've had in the past, but there is this nice brightness that reminds me of a very floral characteristic. Something that reminds me of the fresh air in like springtime that I wasn't getting from the Skunktown, because the Skunktown to me is a little more earthy. I think I recall, like, as I've been typing this up to other people in my life, I'm like, it's potato vodka, and it actually kind of tastes like potatoes. Sort of? Maybe? I'm actually very curious to see, like, how the starchiness of, let's say, these potatoes go into this vodka as opposed to the Woo Woo vodka, which I want to say was a grain-based vodka. Exactly what grains, I'm not so sure, but I vaguely recall that that was the notes that we gained from our waitress when we were at Cape Charles Distillery, which was a part of our journey down to a little wedding in the Outer Banks, which was absolutely lovely. We purchased a number of other bottles down there as well as a part of that journey, because I wanted to try to get a taste of North Carolina before I really knew that I was stopping in North Carolina. And so, because we were in the Outer Banks, I picked something up from North Carolina while we were down there, and it was a little difficult to find, honestly, because when we went to the liquor store, there wasn't a local spirits area that you would go to. You kind of went up to the person at the desk and was like, hey, do you have any spirits local? They're like, no. And I was like, okay, well, do you have any spirits from North Carolina? I know it's a pretty big state, but I know you've got to have something. There was a very, very small shelf in the corner that had a number of different items on it, one of them being this little Bogue Sound distillery bottle of salted caramel, American small batch John A.P. Connolly, which is a salted caramel infused spirits. Not necessarily a whiskey of sort. It is just a spirit. It doesn't say exactly what's in it. It is just a salted caramel spirit. And I say spirit because it's not a liqueur. There's not as much sugar in this as you may think it is. At least that's what I can recall, right? There's nothing on here that says liqueur. Spirits distilled from grain containing natural flavor and color. Bogue Sound Distillery, American small batch, 75 proof. It's got a lot of alcohol in it. I did not have the pleasure of being able to visit the distillery. I have literally no idea where it is, but if anybody out there from there is listening, I like your salted caramel. I do like it very much. And we'll give that another taste here as well. I'll swap this out, get this a little clean. Not doing all the stuff today. I will say, when you're going around doing multiple distilleries in a trip, naturally, if you have a shift in the driving, you don't have to drink all the spirits. Oftentimes, I was actually very impressed to find the pricing of spirit flights at various different distilleries that we went to. There was one flight that gave us four different spirits, and that was, I think the one was four different spirits for $7. We had five different spirits for $5. I'm like, this is great. They don't really give you that much of them, but they do give you just enough to experience the flavor of what they're creating in their little houses and stuff, which is cool. I don't know anything about Bogue Sound Distillery. I just know about the way that it tastes, and I picked it up in the liquor store, and that's about as far as that goes, because if I had the pleasure of talking to somebody from it, I have more details from there, because my brain picks up that information, and hopefully it'll make its way into the blog later. This is a salted caramel spirit. It kind of smells kind of like isopropyl alcohol. It doesn't really have a lot of a very flavorful smell on the nose. It's not very candy-like. However, it tastes... We'll see about that. Immediately getting notes of like butterscotch. It is probably, it's not as sweet as none really come to mind. To be honest, one of the reasons I grabbed this bottle was because I don't have any sort of salted caramel spirits in the collection here at the Bar with an X, so I was like, this feels like a really, really cool cocktail component, because that flavor doesn't exist. I know there are salted caramel, I think, vodkas out there. I want to say Pinnacle does a salted caramel. I think maybe, I don't know, somebody else definitely does a salted caramel vodka. I just remember the little orange with little bits of white salt on top of it, little truffle that you see on the Pinnacle bottles. I have the Pinnacle Whip down there, but it's behind two other bottles, and I'm just too lazy to do so. There's so much else to cover this evening. But it does have, it kind of tastes like butterscotch. There is a little bit of that caramel note that really sits around in your mouth. It's like a salted caramel in that it's not like, let's say, the carameliness of a slightly burnt or slightly toasted simple syrup. It's got a certain umaminess to it, a certain savoriness to it that I would liken to... Anna and I have made honey burgers before, where you take honey and you actually put it into the burger meat and you roll it up and you give it a grill. And there is a certain savory sweetness about that, because it's literally honey and meat together. And I do kind of get that here, which salt can be known for giving that sort of savory flavor to that. It's very, very pleasant. And I immediately after getting this was like, I want to put this in some iced coffee. So we went to the store and grabbed some cold brew and I put this into it. I think to my full cup of coffee, I added about 2 ounces or about 59 milliliters to it. And it was absolutely delicious. It's like adding a little bit of caramel syrup, a little bit of salted caramel syrup to your little cup of joe, whether it is hot or cold. I really like the taste of that. It reminds me of a Werther's original, but in the most like with a bit more of a bite at the end of it. If your Werther's original, this is about to get a little weird for a second. If your Werther's original was chewed by your grandfather who happened to be sipping on some whiskey or vodka beforehand and spat it back out and was like, "Here, our son, you can have the rest of it," then that's probably what this would taste like. It tastes like my alcoholic grandfather. I don't have an alcoholic grandfather. This is just a metaphor. Just vibe with me for a moment there. It is very good. I would totally recommend that going into anything coffee related. If you had a chocolate drink that you want to modify a little bit, and your coffee drink that you want to modify a little bit, that would be an excellent, excellent addition. And I hope that there are some things elsewhere that some cocktails later on at the bar with an X, we'll actually be able to showcase that characteristic of John A.P. Connolly, American small batch cult of caramel from Bogue Sound Distillery, crafting quality spirits. How incredibly vague and rather uplifting. Because we wouldn't want them to be crafting anything else. So this kind of covers the more or less piece of our journey that happened before the actual journey that we took, where we went to a little wedding down in the Outer Banks. We naturally had to start, we've had trips to New Jersey and whatnot and otherwise. We also had a trip about a month ago up for Memorial Day weekend where I got to see my brother in Vermont, where I picked up this little bottle of Smuggler's Notch from Jeffersonville, Vermont. And that was during the Memorial Day weekend. Now, when I was up there hanging with my bro, we were having a whole kind of like housewarming party for him because he had just done a little bit of moving up there. And so a part of that was naturally somebody needed to go source the liquor, which I happily volunteered to do. And we stopped by the local liquor store, and it was one of those things where we didn't necessarily know what was local or not. The people at the front didn't really have this idea of exactly what was from around here and what was otherwise, but there was right near the door this tall bottle with this little piece of paper on top of it that said Small Batch Vermont that told me immediately that this is probably the taste of the state. It is whiskey that has been infused with maple syrup from Vermont itself, and the back of the bottle gives a little bit of history. Hand bottled by Smuggler's Notch Distillery, Jeffersonville, Vermont. Did not get to visit Smuggler's Notch, but I'm sure one day I hopefully will. The name, Smuggler's Notch, captures the legacy of the smugglers who used this thickly forested, rugged mountain pass with its surrounding caves to move goods and liquor from Canada into the United States. Although we don't need to smuggle anymore, we provide a commodity worthy of the cause. Smuggler's Notch Distillery is proud to offer maple straight bourbon whiskey. 100% pure Vermont maple syrup that has been aged in our bourbon barrels is blended with award-winning Smuggler's Notch Distillery straight bourbon whiskey. Our small batch bourbon embodies Vermont's mountain spirit. This here is interesting. When I first got it, I was under the impression that this was going to be very, very forward on its maple whiskey notes. It says maple right on the bottle. It's got this cool little like texture to this cool little pattern to it of maple leaves and stuff falling. I'll show you via the cocktail angle because we have the ability to do that. It just looks beautiful. It is a beautiful, beautiful looking bottle. It's totally caught my eye. And so naturally, the packaging may make you think that you're getting an idea of what lies in the inside. And in this case, unless you're a big whiskey connoisseur, I don't know if you'll necessarily get exactly what you think you would get. So again, this is straight bourbon whiskey that's been infused with 100% pure Vermont maple syrup. And I'm still getting used to my legality and stuff of American bourbon and stuff. I'm a denizen of the United States, so I should be up to snuff on that. But if it means that it is straight, that means that I believe it has to be aged at least for 2 years. If it's not aged for at least 2 years, it must be marked on the bottle, and I don't see it marked on the bottle anywhere, so therefore it must be at least 2 years. In, I think, new charred oak barrels. I'm not an authority on that. Somebody can correct me if I'm wrong there, but I'm still learning the thing of things. Later on, we'll talk about a distillery that we went to that uses a sped up maturation process. They mature things a lot quicker than you would if they were just sitting in the barrels on their own. And none of their spirits can be called straight because none of them sit in the barrel for more than 2 years. They're in there for about maybe 24 hours or so. More on that a little bit later. This is their Smuggler's Notch. I got my little snifter glass here. which I utilize for my whiskey sniffing and stuff like that. Now, another glass that I've come across is something called a Glencairn glass, which I did get to use at least two of the distilleries that we went to. I was not able to pick up a glass from either of them. In both cases, in one case, they weren't selling them, and in the other case, the gift shop or bottle shop was closed. One day, I will get my hands on a Glencairn glass, or multiple, because I just love those little things. It feels so freaking bougie. Not straight, you say, Annie says, putting the little pride flag down there. Not straight, honey. Not straight at all. This one's straight, though, if that's your thing. So on the nose, there's a very, very powerful whiskey component. Exactly what that smells like, I'm not exactly sure. I would say that it kind of smells like corn. Not even corn. It kind of smells like grain. Exactly what that grain is. It's giving me that like, you're on a farm without the smell of the animals and stuff, but you're near the trough where the animals might eat out of, like the horses and stuff or the pigs. But again, I don't smell any mud. I don't smell any straw. I just smell like grain. It's kind of like in the middle of when you got those dried oatmeal boxes in your cabinet and you haven't quite, you know, made the oatmeal with it yet. Kind of smells a little bit like that, or like cream of wheat or grits. Something like that. It's kind of cabinet-y, if I will be so specific about it. I don't really know. This is just, I'm grasping at maple leaves here. What does it taste like, though? So I got my first taste there, and the first thing that I'm getting, I've tasted this a couple times over the past couple days, because we did a little bit of a private tasting for some of our friends on our way, on our journey back. This is very vaguely maple syrupy. There is a sweetness at the very, very end that sticks around that is reminiscent of those little maple candies that you can get up in Vermont or probably elsewhere in the world as well. It's not necessarily sweet. There is a syrupiness to it, not because of the viscosity, not because of the sweetness, but because of that residual flavor that to me is almost woody in a way. It's caramelly in a way. But for the most part, this is a very corn-forward whiskey. And I find that I just had like a, what was it? What proof is this guy? 95? 90 proof. So this is the highest proof spirit I think that we've gotten so far, maybe. So my taste buds have opened up a little bit. So I don't think I got all the flavor characteristics there. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to swirl it around a little bit more, give it a little more air. I'm going to go for another sip, because I want to get all those characteristics that I can. Now, of note too, with whiskey, you can also add just a little bit of water to this to open up some of the more floral notes, which, honestly, we can do. So I'll do that in a little bit too to see if it changes it up a little bit. Yeah. Very, very corny. Very, very corny. I find that there's one particular spirit in the bar with an X right now called Larceny Small Batch, that was the thing that made corn make sense to me. And this in particular has those notes of sweet corn. Not necessarily the corn kernels themselves, although just a little bit, but it reminds me of the hairs of the corn. If you ever eat corn on the cob and you take a bite off and there's one of those hairs that remain, that's kind of what it reminds me of. And so what I'll do here now is I'll add just a touch of water to this. And what this does is science, evidently. It kind of opens up those more flavor-forward components there that wouldn't otherwise come up if you didn't add water to it. Exactly what that science is, I'm not exactly sure, but I think it involves phenols and flavanols and other chemicals of the sort. In any case, a little bit of hydration will go far for your whiskey tasting, or bourbon. In this case, it is bourbon. And I can confirm that. So, after adding just the slightest bit of water to it, instead of it being more those kind of corn notes, I'm actually tasting something that is a little more sweet. That was actually probably the most stark contrast between one sip to another that I've had recently. This was actually very, very interesting. Now, instead of those maple whiskey notes being more towards on the end of the spectrum, I got it a little bit on the beginning, in the sense that maple syrup to me is a very warming spirit. Maple syrup is a very warming syrup to me. It reminds me of pancake houses. It reminds me of the pancakes underneath. In general, this is kind of like if you were to take a hot pancake and drizzle a little bit of maple syrup on it. And so long as that pancake is still hot and it's a little soak, and you take just the tightest bit of the end, I'm talking like the edges of the pancake that haven't quite, that are just a little bit too browned, one of those. but certainly not nearly as sweet. I see little Abe popping in here saying, weird science, weirdest of science. I don't even know how this science stuff works, but it do, and it makes the whole experience even more spectacular. So I'm gonna quickly move on to the other spirits, because for the most part, I would say those spirits are old spirits. We've gone through those before. None of those spirits are new. They may have found their way to the bar with an X previously, but that's not really why I wanted to do the stream. That's not why I wanted to do the whole spirits road trip thing. I wanted to give some details about the road trip that we took. And so that's where we're gonna start on there. I'll take ourselves back to the map behind me so we can get a little more details on what it is that, what the heck that we are doing. So I got a couple of things all cleaned off over here and we shall resume. Let's go back into this. We will first talk about the first leg of this little triangle journey that Anna and I took. And we'll get a little bit closer. Check out my new shirt. It says, you called in sick? Yeah, sick as hell. It's awesome. And I'm wearing my crafted poor hat. They're pretty cool. Let's see. So the first leg of our journey naturally started in great old Philadelphia, or somewhere around this area over here. We made our way from Philadelphia down to Hilton Head, South Carolina, where my family frequents for their family vacation. Along the way, we made a couple of different stops. We did not stop in Delaware. We were there for about, I think, maybe an hour or so and did not have a chance to stop. It was right after work on Friday, and I could go to Delaware anytime I want to, so it didn't really feel like it was important. Granted, I will say, I take shame, I take responsibility. I did not pick up a bottle in Delaware, but I did pick up a bottle in Maryland, and we were there for quite a little bit. We stopped in a place in Maryland, and I just kind of walked into whatever liquor store that we had there, and lo and behold, I didn't realize that a distillery called Sagamore is Maryland-based, and I didn't realize that before going into this liquor store. I went in, and I asked, what do you got? Anything that's local? And they said, well, Sagamore's right around the corner, and I was like, what? Sagamore? So yeah, Sagamore whiskey. They sell Sagamore over here in Pennsylvania as well, at least at my liquor store, but the bottles that I can get there are about $65 to $70, and I wasn't going to just take a chance on that in this particular circumstance if it was right up the road. So this bottle here was about $30, this rye here. And we'll taste that in a little bit of a piece of that journey there. The next stop that we made, the next state that we might have been making our way through, was naturally Virginia. Now, I did have something in Virginia already. The Virginia spirit, naturally, in this case, was going to be the... I thought I did. Did I? Right? What am I doing in Virginia? Oh, it was the Cape Charles. The Cape Charles Distillery, which was technically our Virginia state. Now, I don't think we had any significant stops in Virginia. I think we stopped at a garden, perhaps. Or that was in Delaware when we stopped. So I guess technically, I didn't pick it up from the state that I stopped in. But that's okay. That's fine. But that was our spirit that we got from Virginia. There's an entire other... Virginia's huge, and we passed through there relatively recently. I'm curious if anybody has any suggestions of distilleries or particular bottles that you know are from Virginia. I'm very curious to see what those brands are, because after the realization of Sagamore and Maryland, there are some really popular brands that you can find that aren't just, let's say, Kentucky or Tennessee because of the whole bourbon whiskey trail thing. But after Virginia, we made our way down to North Carolina, and then South Carolina, and then hung around this area in the South Carolina and Georgia area, where we got a couple more bottles as well. Now, I'll take ourselves back out again as I introduce to you the bottles on the journey. Now, unfortunately enough, one of the states that we spent the most time in, aside from Indiana, was South Carolina, where I was hanging with my family. And we had a bunch of fun going to the shops and whatnot, the various shops that we frequent on a yearly basis. It was nice to spend time with the family and also the friends that we've made down there along the way. I stopped at a number of different spice shops and whatnot, which I will go through. That part of the journey was mostly characterized by reagents and ingredients and stuff, and not necessarily spirits. The spirits were actually bottles that I wasn't able to pick up, but we'll get to that in a moment. The first bottle of that journey, from that first leg of the journey, is this Sagamore Rye. And the Sagamore Rye is Sagamore Rye. Sagamore Spirit is something that I don't have too much history on. I have not been to the Sagamore Distillery, and by the time that we got to Maryland, they were closed for the day. I believe it was around 7:30 p.m., and for the most part, distilleries just kind of like stop doing tastings after a certain time, or they close their kitchens, or they close their doors down. I get it. I understand. The back of our Sagamore bottle shares that Sagamore Spirit Rye Whiskey is a blend of two straight rye mash bills aged 4 to 6 years in high char American oak barrels. The first is a high rye, which adds notes of cinnamon and clove, and the second a low rye, contributing notes of caramel, honey, and citrus peel. The final spirit is proofed with limestone filtered water from our spring house built in 1909 and represents our team's thoughtful approach to crafting a classic Maryland-style rye whiskey. What exactly makes a Maryland style, I'm not exactly sure about, but the folks over at Sagamore have apparently got that down to a T. So I want to give this guy a taste. I'm going to do a little drying of my snifter here because I don't want to inadvertently add water to this yet. I want to see how the flavor changes over time as we, you know, try it dry first and then wet it up a little bit. We'll see how it goes from there. Because with the difference that we got from the Smuggler's Notch from Vermont, I'm very, very curious to see what the Sagamore does. Now, intuitively, if adding a little bit of water brings forth those more sweeter flavors, those flavors that are a little more candy-like, a little more sugary-like, then my intuition says that the first thing that we're gonna taste here is a little bit of that char oak barrel. We're gonna get those notes of cabinet spices like cinnamon and clove and whatnot. And after we add just a little bit of moisture to it, we're gonna get those more sweet notes like from the honey and the caramel and stuff. So that's my intuition. We'll see if we put that to the test. I am by no means an authority on this. I'm just a person who likes to drink spirits like I'm sure 90% or plus more, 99% of the people out there as well. I'm one of you, or at least I try to identify as such. I'm just, how am I different? I don't know. I got a different genome than you do. I don't have a twin, so. Sagamore Rye. This one's been popped open. I tried a little bit of this with my mother while I was hanging down with her in South Carolina. Now, my mother is not a whiskey gal. She's not a drinking spirits straight kind of gal. I've apparently become that kind of gal as I've gotten older. So when I was like, yo, you need to try this. It kind of tastes like honey. She was like, whew, I want a cocktail. And so a cocktail we made for her. I will say, let's see, this was Maryland. There was another thing along the way that I might've forgotten about. I didn't actually track it on here. Oh, no, I did track it on there. That's in our other piece of North Carolina. We'll get to that in a second. I want to make sure I don't forget that one. So our Sagamore spirit. I don't know why. It kind of smells like how my bathroom does. Not a bad way. I mean, like in terms of cleaning, maybe cleaning product a little bit, like the underneath of my sink and stuff. It's alcoholic. I can smell the alcohol there. There are probably other characteristics there that if I just like. Focus a little bit more on my nostrils are flaring up. I don't know how to piece out those flavors there. I would say if I had to make a comparison to candy, it's almost pepperminty. It's almost minty in a way. And if I had to relate the pepperminty to any of the notes of the back of the bottle, I'd say that sometimes peppermint can kind of be a little cinnamony. So I'm gonna say it kind of smells like cinnamon in my opinion. What it tastes like though is something that I'm a little bit more proficient at. A little bit. Oh yeah. Ooh yeah, I'm really liking that. So right off, what I'm getting is that rye characteristic to it. Rye whiskeys have been said to be spicy in a way, in the sense that cinnamon is also spicy. Some other spices are spicy. I believe the proper term is piquant. P-I-Q-U-A-N-T maybe. It's very nice. I like that characteristic. To me, it is the combination of spiciness, like what I get from cinnamon, and bitterness, like what I get from, you know, searing my marshmallow way too long on the campfire. It's not smoky, I'll make that known. It's burnt like burnt toast. Actually, it's burnt flavor as if you were to burn or singe a little bit of rye toast, which to me, rye toast doesn't really have the same bite as some rye whiskeys do, but just as like there's a multitude of different types of wheat and grain, there's a multitude of different types of rye out there. There's not necessarily just one. And that, I think, is pretty cool. And when I think about the rye, actually, this is kind of tangential going back to the Cape Charles distillery from previously, that rye whiskey that I didn't get to take home with me, there was something really, really, really unique about that. And that's something I want to make sure that I don't forget to share, is that the Cape Charles Distillery Rye Whiskey is a whiskey that utilizes malted rye as a part of their mash bill. Now, anybody who's a whiskey guy or whiskey person might think to themselves, like, I've never really heard of malted rye before. And if you have, I'd like to know where you heard it from, because out of all the journey, I've had. Nowhere have I seen malted rye as a part of a mash bill. Malted barley is something that I've seen very, very commonly, but malted rye is not something that I'm very familiar with. I went to a couple of the other distilleries I went to. Every time I tried a rye, I would ask, hey, have you heard of malted rye as a part of a mash bill? And not a single one of them nodded their head yes. They were all like, I've never thought of malted rye before. I don't really know how you would do that. I don't know why you'd put that in whiskey, but I guess you could. And people were kind of confused about that, which is kind of cool, which is why I'm still kind of like thinking, man, I really wish I could have picked up that bottle. It is the Cape Charles Distillery Rye. And the next time I go down there, the next time I see it, so long as we got the budget for it, I'm gonna pick up a bottle of that, because there's something about that rye that just exists in my head that I really, really want again. There's something so cool about it. But alas, enough about that rye. Those are the ryes of the past. Let's talk about the ryes about the now. The Sagamore Rye. It is cinnamony. It has a bit of burntness to it. I'm getting those notes. It's also a bit sweet too. What I got from here, from this sip here and my first sip while I was hanging out with my family, is that it was almost this honey-like characteristic to it. It's the slightest bit sweet. It's the slightest bit earthy. Not earthy like the leaves on the forest floor, earthy like the wood of the tree that the beehive was sitting in. And it was really, really cool. And I don't think I gave it a proper taste test with a little bit of addition of cold water here, so I'm really curious to see what that is going to do, because I imagine those notes of honey and stuff are going to get even more exaggerated, and for me, that's going to be quite a treat. Another thing that I'm trying to do here, aside from being able to share with the world out here, is to increase my awareness of the different flavors that exist out there in the world of spirits. I am very, very early on in my spirits and mixology career. I have really only been seriously thinking about mixology for about 2 years or so when I started my live streaming journey. So the tips that I, the realizations that I'm coming to here are totally authentic. It's just from the experience that I've given myself so far, and that's something that anybody out there can do with enough time, effort, and dedication and stuff. And even you don't even have to not have to have the dedication for it either. You find a bottle that strikes your fancy, give it a shot, literally. Or give it a sniff, or give it a sip. I think that's how you would get to this point. One day, hopefully, we'll be at the points of the pros and stuff, and we'll be able to show our worth. One day, who knows? But there's a little bit of water added to the Sagamore Rye. I'm hoping for something a bit more honey for it, because, oh my god, I'm like Winnie the Pooh. I love me some honey. I can't do a Winnie the Pooh impression. Not as much. You know, it's not as much honey as it was without the water. Actually, this did get a little bit sweeter. It did get a little more fruity in a way, actually. It reminds me of a maraschino liqueur or a Kirschwasser eau de vie. It's got that... It's not cherry sweet, but it's cherry adjacent, which is very, very interesting. It's only a very slightly like wooded cherry note that I recall from other bottles that I've tasted previously. In addition, that cinnamon note, which was a little more dry, a little more grated cinnamon before, transformed into something that was a little more glycol, a little more syrup, a little more confectionery. This tastes, has a certain spice characteristic that feels a little more close to a red hot type of cinnamon, more so than a salon cinnamon stick type of cinnamon that you would get from your closet. It's very, very interesting, and this is more like a candy-like delicacy type of whiskey, as opposed to others that I've had in the past, which are a little more down to earth, literally, like forest floor and otherwise. I see Rye popping in a chat saying, wait, I'm on your table? Well, my dreams have come true. It's a miracle, I say, and it's a pleasure to have you on the table as well, Rye. Sagamore Spirit Rye, that is. There are many different versions of rye that exist out there. This is just the version that exists here. And I think that may actually be the only rye whiskey that I picked up along my trip. And that is the case. So you will be on the table for just a little bit longer, Rye. Just a little bit longer as we kind of... I was gonna say, I finished up my notes here. That's pretty much where else I was going with that. A very lovely rye indeed. I think the only other ryes that I've had in my collection have been Old Forester and Rittenhouse Rye. Rittenhouse Rye is what made the Manhattan make sense to me. Old Forester Rye was just my first bottle of rye, and it was gone too quickly for me to truly appreciate it. So hopefully I can savor this rye the best that I possibly can as we move forward with another spirit on our journey as we continue down the leg of our journey. I see Rye also saying, sorry, Mr. Tripp, it just hasn't been a good time at work. No problem, my guy, no problem at all. I hope that these sort of travels that we do become maybe not necessarily more frequent, but I am positive that we will make our way down to the Bourbon Trail again someday. And I hope then that situations are a bit better. And because of the way that situations are right now, all I can hope is that things continue to go well on your side, as I hope they are going on everybody's side as well. You have my sincerest condolences. You have my sincerest support. And this remainder of a shot I will pour out for you and the people in your life, mostly because I have more spirits to taste, and that one's going back in the bucket. I will say, there is a lot in this bucket right now. It's a kind of half water and half spirit. If somebody reminds me, maybe I'll take a little bit of a taste of the spirit jungle juice that has been collecting in Taylor, and maybe we try that a little bit later. You're very welcome out there, Brian. You're very welcome. But let's move on. We're out of Maryland now, and we're making our way farther down south. We've hit Virginia now, and Virginia's weird. I don't know what it is about Virginia cops and the speed limit and stuff. I am afraid to go any more than 2 to 3 miles over the speed limit in Virginia, and Virginia only. Not necessarily West Virginia, just Virginia. And I don't really know what the shtick is about that, and that is kind of weird to me. But I did cover a spirit that we picked in Virginia already, specifically Cape Charles Distillery in Virginia along the coast, so I will not be picking up a bottle from Virginia again. Instead, I'm gonna swiftly make our way farther down south into North Carolina, where we had a brief repast with one of our friends that's out there here. We had the absolute pleasure of visiting our friend More Than Awesome, AKA Brad, and we had a wonderful lunch outing together, and we met them for like, I think it was an early breakfast or so at one of the places around their area. And one of the beauties of being able to meet up with somebody who has been a guest on the show before and a regular at the Bar with an X is, naturally, we have similar tastes that we know how to gift each other for. So what Brad wound up donating to the cause is this beautiful purple bottle of Conniption Kinship Blue Purplish Gin from Durham, North Carolina, which I saw that as I was like, I feel like he was threatening me before that he got there. He's like, I might have a bottle for you. I was like, you don't have to do that. He's like, no, I think I'm gonna give you a bottle from the area. And lo and behold, this is where we are. So this is the Conniption Kinship gin that we have that is made in Durham. It's got this cute little thing on the side that says that a natural indigo hue changes color with citrus. It goes from this kind of dark purpley to a light purpley. It's beautiful. It's nature's art. Conniption science. Kindred spirits. Virginia is for cousin lovers, says Rye. Virginia is for lovers. It was so interesting seeing that on every single, like, license plate around Virginia. It was like, Virginia's for lovers? What kind of lovers? Like the lovers arcana. Persona. But in any case, Conniption Gin. Conniption Gin here is the purple stuff. The back of this bottle has a beautiful little narrative that I will recollect for you all now. The connection between... Actually, let's do it more essentially. The connection between science and art is the rooted heart of Conniption Kinship. There is inherent elegance and harmony in its handcrafted distillation and blending. First, botanicals of juniper, Indian coriander, cardamom, licorice root, bitter orange, and angelica root fully develop their flavors from the hot steam vapor process of traditional pot distillation. Then, the botanicals of fresh orange and lemon peels, honeysuckle flowers, and ripe peeled cucumbers are individually cold distilled on our modern rotary evaporators to ensure their authentic flavors. All are blended together before adding pure, distilled, and deionized water. A lasting alliance is formed in our final step, where we infuse the gin with butterfly pea flowers, resulting in a beautiful indigo hue. Sensual and sexy. And so as I pour this into the glass, I wanna let y'all be able to see what's going on here. There's a little bottle in the corner. Give that a pop. I did make for my mother a very interesting gin and lemonade drink that did indeed change its colors as we added the lemonade, which is pretty freaking cool. This is our bottle here. This is the color of our bottle to begin with. This is not what the bottle color is. This is actually the liquid that is on the inside, which is cool. If you've been to the Bar with an X before, you've seen our butterfly pea flower gin. This is not necessarily new. This is that beautiful, like, sapphire color that sits at the bottom of the glass. I don't know why I put it in the snifter, but I happen to do so. And honestly, I'm not regretting that. It's just got a beautiful, beautiful sapphire color to it. My favorite color is evidently ultramarine, which is a sapphire type blue. And if this is the closest that I've seen it in a spirit before, and it is just absolutely delightful looking. And this thing smells wonderful. I was giving it a smell as I was swirling it around, and my goodness, this is a good one. So our butterfly pea flower will impart a color. It can also impart a flavor. Exactly what that flavor is, I can only describe as floral because I don't have any other way to describe it right now. I just haven't gotten that flavor profile in my flavor palette just yet to be able to describe succinctly. Now, there's also a bunch of other stuff in here. In particular, there was that angelica root. Don't really know what that is. We have juniper. I know what that is. It's gin. Indian coriander. Coriander, I don't really know how to taste yet. Cucumber was in there. I think I mentioned cucumber already. And lemon stuff and citrus stuff and whatnot. There's a lot of botanicals that go into this little conniption here. And I may or may not have myself a little conniption as I go through this and stuff. Because it just looks very, very good. And when I recall, I did taste this already with my mother. And she also had that kind of like, I'm not a gin girl. And I was like, I am a spirit person. So I'm going to sip this happily. Rye says, is that the color changing one if you mix it with citrus? You are absolutely right. Instead of this beautiful blue color, it's going to turn to like a kind of light pink. And I would do that for you now, but there's so much else to explore. And if you want to see that kind of stuff, I'm sure the color purple and its corresponding pink in a more acidic version will find its way back to the bar with an X at a later date. Maybe we'll do an entire episode on color changing drinks, which now that I think about it would be a really, really cool idea. So right off the nose, I was about to take the sip of it, but I gotta appreciate this first. Smells like gin and vodka, but a little bit of gin. I would say that kind of smells like if you're chopping up, not citrus. Not if you're chopping up citrus. This is not, I mean, to me, this is not very citrus zesty. This is, I'm cutting up an herb and I can't quite pinpoint what that herb is. It is vegetal, it is herby, it is light, it is bright. It is light and it's bright. It kind of smells like fresh air in a way. Almost kind of like cucumber, but not quite there. Certainly not the outside of the cucumber, maybe a little bit on the inside of the cucumber. It's very bright, very herbal. I really like that smell. Compared to other gins, let me just grab my beef eater down here to do just a very quick comparison. This is a London Dry. This is, I don't really know, honestly, right? This is a London Dry? Yeah, it's a London Dry. As opposed to being a little more on the juniper side, more on the, I'd say this is actually less bright than our London Dry. And our London Dry almost has that aspect of like, almost like flowing water. It's like a fresh spring. Whereas this is a little more inland, a little more earthy in a way, a little more of the plants, more so than the sea, if that makes any sense at all. It's probably weed. I think the color changes want to make a great show. Magic cocktails. It's probably the weed. Or maybe it's the other hallucinogenic substances. When we get to Georgia, I have some interesting things to share about things that I purchased at a local mart. It'll be fun. We'll get there. Just stick around along for the rest of the journey. We've got plenty of stories to come. So it smells very herbally. It smells very, I said the words already. Imagine leaves. Now imagine leaves that go on food. Now imagine those leaves that go on food being cut up in such a way in a cool environment. That's what I'm talking about. That's the conniption. Time for the taste. Ooh. Oh yeah. It is so, ooh, I love that. There is a piece of that is kind of bitter-like. A nice type of bitter. It's like cucumber. But it's like cucumber, but it's also kind of like black pepper. But it's not quite just black pepper. There's a bitterness there that reminds me of like other herbs and stuff. Almost like a mint, but not quite a mint. There's also this bright like essence of zest there. Not particularly any particular type of zest. Not necessarily lemon, not necessarily orange. Just that sort of citrus zest air to it. Like you zested your citrus over top of the cocktail and you've pushed it away to somebody. I'm speaking from the bartender's perspective, and that zesty flavor, that zesty smell is going away from you. And it's kind of like that zestiness is out in the distance. That's kind of what it reminds me of. It's like making zested cocktails for other people, maybe not zested, expressed cocktails for other people, and then putting them away and putting them to the other side of the bar and smelling as they walk away. Not smelling the person as they walk away. This does not smell like a human. It smells like what the human would be drinking or imbibing, or maybe what the human is walking over, because I did have those notes of herbs and stuff from before, and I still maintain by those. It's very, very nice. I would say this is a lot less drying of a gin as opposed to a London Dry, for instance. Some of the gins that I've tasted in the past can be very dry on the palate. It kind of dries you out. This is a little more hydrating. It doesn't leave me as dry in terms of texture as it does in terms of flavor. There is a notable bitterness there coming from those more herby characteristics that are sticking around, but it's not like it's a texture. It's not like my tongue feels like sandpaper. It's just kind of like the air in my mouth feels a little more cool, a little more, but also a little more arid at the same time, if that sort of makes sense to you. I want to, again, thank More Than Awesome for providing this beautiful bottle of Conniption, the Kinship, which I think is it's a metaphor in a very beautiful way. And to the both of you out there, you have my kindest regards, and I just want to reiterate how much of a pleasure it was to even see y'all for just a brief moment in time. It was a pleasure, and I look forward to our next time as well. But alas, that was only a momentary stop in our journey. I will say that morning, before we wound up meeting up with More Than Awesome and the crew, we were actually stayed at a little Airbnb in Richmond, Virginia, and we went to a lovely little coffee place in the morning called Roastology, which I do have pictures, I think, of. I don't know if they're posted anywhere, but they have like the big coffee roasting machines that you can see through a window. They had like three or four completely filled up shelves of different blends of coffee and stuff. It looked amazing, but we were only there for breakfast, and I had their simple cup of drip because I just wanted to try what they were doing for their drip, and it was pretty good. It definitely set the right tone for the morning for the drive of the way. But alas, we continue with our drive journey. So after that first part of North Carolina, we proceeded down south to South Carolina. There was a couple of different spots that we stopped along the way. I want to say there might have been a thrift store stuff there. There might have been another distillery. Let me think if there were any more distilleries that way. I don't think there were. Trying to think. I think most of the distilleries were elsewhere in the trip. I'm having a hard time remembering exactly what it was, but we did make our way down to South Carolina, where we did visit at least one distillery before we actually made it to go see the rest of my parents. And that was a place called Burnt Church Distillery. Now, while we were down in South Carolina, I actually didn't pick up any bottles from there whatsoever, unfortunately, because the circumstance just that just wasn't in the cards, unfortunately. So while we were in South Carolina, we had the opportunity to taste from two different distilleries, notably Burnt Church Distillery and Hilton Head Distillery, which is the island that we stay on for our little family vacations. Now, Burnt Church Distillery, by the time that we got there, the kitchen was just about closing. I was able to order a flight, which I hope to be able to put notes above after the fact, but there is a post on Instagram that gives just a general idea of what the vibe was like there. But the bottle shop was closed. They weren't able to sell liquor after that hour, so I wasn't able to pick up a bottle there. We could have stopped there on our way off the island, but it was just too far out of the way. We had that second leg of our journey from South Carolina up to Indianapolis was a really, really long day. We just didn't have time to stop. I will say that they have a wonderful bourbon that my brother picked up, and I think it's called Anita's Blend. And that one was very, very nice. I don't have the full, actually, I do have the full tasting notes. Let me pull those up real quick, because some of them were very, 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 very good. Let me pull those up. They're in one of these apps. I have so many different, I was just talking to my content buddy, Lycos Lord, the other day, and I literally have no idea how to keep my notes aligned, so it takes me a little bit to even find any of them, but they are in here somewhere. And I did find my notes on Burnt Church Distillery. I tried a number of different spirits. I think the only ones that I actually got notes on were these five that I got in my first flight, which I think was a chill $5, I think. Thank you, Burt Church. And thank you to, it's a beautiful place. And there was some guy there who didn't think that we'd be able to get a table because the kitchen was closing so soon, but he totally made it work for us. And that was probably the best pizza that I've had. They got really, really good food down there at the Burt Church. I will definitely say that. And I thank you all again for your hospitality. So the five that we tried was the Devil's Elbow. And I wanna say that was gin. That was definitely gin. They had the Devil's Elbow gin, which, according to my tasting notes, tasted like freshly cracked pepper over a cucumber. Like you've bitten into the cucumber and immediately bitten to peppercorn, but without all the dryness. Cucumber taste really sticks around and lays dryly on the tongue. Every time I burp, I can still taste the cucumber. This is after I tasted all of the other spirits as well. And if I had the ability to put up like the pictures of all this stuff, I would, but we're still kind of unpacking from our trip, and I'm still very tired from the journey, to be perfectly honest, so I did not have the time to do that. I apologize. I hope that they will make their way into the blog later. It's going to be a very amorphous blog, so if you're not already a part of that and you want to keep up with that kind of stuff, it's posted in our Discord server, and it may make its way to other platforms if I have the time to edit and narrate that stuff. It's a busy life that we live. But if you're not in there and you want to see that stuff, the Discord is where you will find it. And I will give even fuller recollections as I have time to sit down and really think about this for a little while, to give pictures and other stuff from the journey. It's going to be a lot of fun for me, and I hope you'll join me for that. The next thing that we tried was their Palmer Stretch Rye Whiskey, which was almost like biting into a cinnamon peppermint candy cane, but certainly not as sweet. Those are all the notes that I had on that. That one didn't particularly stick out to me. The other, another bottle I had was the Bluffton American Whiskey, and I, end quote, have this in my notes saying, "I swear to God, this smells like a gummy bear mixed with cough syrup." Crying laughing emoji. Lasting notes from the barley and immediately sweet from the rice, perhaps. I think at this point I was a little tired from our journey. That was like the very, very end of the drive, right before we got to the hotel that we stayed in for a couple of days. And also just the jovialness of being around my family, who I hadn't seen all together for quite some time now. It was a joy of mine. That other bottle that I was mentioning, that Anita's Choice Bourbon Whiskey, was something that I gave notes of having notes of rye, very prominent, still getting some of those faint peppermint notes either from the whiskey I was trying previously or otherwise. I think my notes were not super duper detailed here, because I think this was the second distillery that I wound up going to. I've gotten into the habit of taking more complete notes, and I've done that for a couple of the other spirits that we have around here. It's a sort of an exercise that I'm keeping myself to, and it's actually kind of fun. And then the last bottle that we tried there, that I at least have notes of, is the Devil's Elbow Regular Gin, which has slight notes of licorice, but is super duper junipery, which that's all the notes that I have there. So Burnt Church, excellent hospitality. It looked absolutely beautiful. They had this awesome stained glass window that right as we got there, right as the sun was setting, it beamed into this little area where they got the bar right in the middle. They got their stained glass in the background. They got their bottle wall. They got live music. They've got an area that you can go and purchase bottles and look a little bit at the history of stuff, which was closed. And they had a waterfall in the men's bathroom that you could piss onto. And there was a shirt on the wall that says, I don't know, it was something like, "I peed on the wall" or something like that. Rye popping in here with the sub? My God, 3 months? You can lick the devil's elbow, but not your own. One of those days I'm gonna need you to seriously do a cocktail making ASMR video. My God, thank you, Rye. I'm so jacked up here. I'm so pumped up. But yeah, I pissed on a wall in a church. And that was freaking awesome, dude. I absolutely loved that. That was great. Let me see. I'm also realizing that I can click buttons and clip things, so I'm gonna clip that. I like that. That was great. I like to make things like that. Though, by the way, for my other Twitch tenders or my other people who stream on Twitch out there, did you know that Twitch has sent out an update allowing you to feature your clips in a style that will eventually be sort of like swiping through TikTok and stuff to be able to promote your channel passively while you're not live? I think that's pretty cool. Maybe that'll bring the Bar with an X to the masses. Who really knows? I have no idea. That's the type of thing where if you want to help out with the Bar with an X, do some clips. Share them with your friends if you want to. But if not, that's okay. I'll be here sipping bottles anyway all night, or at least for the next couple of hours or so. That was great. Another great appreciation to Rye, who has been a wonderful force of positivity here at the bar. It's nice to have company, and I appreciate you greatly. So we'll move on. I did not get a chance to get a bottle from Burnt Church Distillery. I think if I was going to get a bottle, it was going to be that cucumber and cracked pepper gin. It was just super duper unique. I had never had something that was that peppery before, and it was really, really nice. And I feel like it would go really well with some. I've definitely had notes from other cocktail mixologists about cocktails that go really well with pepper notes. For example, green chartreuse, I found, can go really well with the other notes of black pepper in some cocktails. That would be something I really wish I could have played around with if I was able to go back for a bottle, which I was not able to do. The next piece of that journey on Hilton Head Island was the hotel that we were staying in. Now, I could go on and on about the various different years that I've spent of my, the days that I've spent over the course of the years of my life down with my family in this beautiful little hotel, and the various different adventures that we've had on the island here, there, and everywhere, walking all across the island, biking all across the island, going to there and being able to experience that with my fiance or my girlfriend after we started dating, and soon to be my wife as well, and the future that we may be able to have either there or elsewhere. It's just a lot of emotion. It's a lot of nostalgia. And I love it so very much. And so it was even cooler to find that in my little mixological habit that I'm forming here, there was actually a taste of the area that I could experience this year too, now finally coming to the age of 25, which I've been for about a year now. I actually got to taste the local area. And one of the things that I was really, really sad about was, again, I couldn't pick up a bottle, but somebody did come by to the hotel that we were staying at and gave out some rum samples from Hilton Head Distillery. Interestingly enough, the rum sample, they have, the hotel has a whole list of activities that you, the family, and otherwise could experience if you were a guest at the hotel, and the rum tasting wasn't on the list. I got there, and so usually there's a 1 to 2 week vacation. My grandmother was down there, and she was like, yeah, they were doing a rum tasting, Cameron, that I think you would really appreciate. And I was like, rum tasting? I want to do some rum tasting. So I go downstairs, I look in the elevator for the list that they have in the wall, and I was like, I don't see any rum on here. What the heck is up with that? So I go back up, I was like, what do you mean rum tasting? I don't see any rum tasting. And they're like, yeah, somebody from the distillery on the island comes by and does rum. And I was like, I need to find some rum. Because one of the really weird things about going around and finding different spirits is that, at least from my journeys in the East Coast of America, you can find vodka, you can find gin, you can find whiskeys and liqueurs of all shapes and sizes, but tequila and mezcal is really hard to find made locally, and so is rum. I have yet to find locally made rums that are actually made locally, you know? Hilton Head Distillery, actually, I got a bit of history about, because they apparently take, I want to say, they give me the most context about the actual process of creating rum, which, not a topic for now, I would talk way too long about it, but maybe the next time we do tiki drinks or rum-type drinks, I can go a little bit more into the history of rum and how it started out in, I believe, Barbados, in, I believe, around the year, century 1600s or so. They actually make their own rum. I think they may get the sugarcane or molasses juice from somewhere else, but all the actual like aging and stuff and distillation happens there on the island. And I think they had to close down for a little bit for COVID and stuff, so it's a bit of a very interesting history for that distillery, and they're still running. Of the notes that I have is vast. I had a lot more notes on the Hilton Head distillery because of, well, it was rums, and I probably wasn't going to be able to pick up any of these. And I just need to find where my notes are on that. Hilton Head Distillery, there we go. I only have one picture from this event. And that was, let's see, I have this picture that I have in my notes over here. Oh, also I just noticed that I forgot to take our little box down here and move it back up in this direction. Cause usually, that's what we were doing for Distillery, we were playing the game. Let me do a little. Move that around just a tad. There we go. That seems about right. That's back where the spot is. I see Rye saying, and I gotta put my screens around a little bit. Let me find the other pictures of me and my fam. Lexington, Kentucky, University of Kentucky, had a ribbon cutting today to officially launch the world's biggest educational distillery. No way! That's so cool! Oh my god, that's so wild. We missed that by like what, a week or so? Oh man. I'm gonna need a personal tour the next time that we're down there. Hopefully, goodness willing. Let's see. I'll show you these things that I had. These are the different bottles that they had there. I'll go through each of those bottles individually. They had a rum cream there. They had a Salerno rum. They had a grilled pineapple rum. It was absolutely delicious. Every one of them offered their own particular style and his own particular taste that I absolutely fell in love with while we were there. It was delicious. The notes that I have include descriptions for all of the rums that I tasted, and I will go through those now for the benefit of the masses. So the first one that we tried was this Salerna rum, which is actually not an ingredient, but a particular process that you can use to make not only just rums, but any other aged spirit. The concept of a Solera rum or a Solera whiskey is that the age of the bottle is a collection of ages of various other things. The concept is kind of like this. If you were to fill up a barrel with grain spirit, which will eventually become whiskey, you can take half of that and bottle it 1 year, right? And then you're gonna take a little bit more, and you're gonna add stuff to it. I might be misquoting this just a little bit, but the idea is that you are taking some from the barrel, filling it back up. Taking some from the barrel, filling it back up year after year after year on a particular interval. So if you had a 6 Solera year rum or whiskey, that means that the oldest molecules, the oldest liquids of whiskey in that barrel are going to be 6 years old. The entire batch is not 6 years old. There's going to be a 6 year old in there, 5 year old, 4 year old, down so on and so forth. And I'm not talking about human children. We're talking about whiskey here or other craft spirits and whatnot. But you will have something that is on average Solera year of 6 there. So their Solera rum is made by that process. The tasting notes that I have for that is that the history of that is that they use oak and sherry wine barrels. They pump out half of the rum from two other vats that they have and dilute it and bottle it up from those two barrels. They harvest it from that mother barrel every 7-ish Solera year barrel. And the molasses that they use for that comes from Louisiana. The notes that I had for tasting notes is it reminded me of caramel, spice of rye, and a little bit of cinnamon. Our distiller explainer guy, who was actually distributing out the rums and stuff and giving us the explanations, described that particular rum as a bourbon drinker, a whiskey sipper's rum. It was a lot more like a bourbon or a whiskey, more so than the rum. Still had that nice sugarcane sweetness or molassesness that a rum tends to have, but there were a lot of those other notes of your wooden barrels or your spice notes like cinnamon and whatnot, and it had a really nice brown color to it that reminded us of the whiskeys and stuff. They also had their own spiced rum that they make totally in-house, which uses Tahitian vanilla, clove, orange peel, cinnamon, star anise, and they make a sort of, the process for making it is sort of, they take all those different botanicals and stuff, and they kind of make a tea out of it. They put it all into water, and they heat it up real good and stuff. Afterwards, they push the rum through a filter and add caramel flavoring afterwards. I think the tea that they're speaking of here, I might have mistranscribed it, is they kind of put it all into the rum that they use as their base for their other rums and stuff, and they kind of make a sort of hot tea out of it. And then they strain out all the other stuff in it, and then they bottle the thing up and add a little bit of caramel at the end. Now, when our guy said they add caramel at the end, I don't know whether or not he meant caramel as in like caramel color or caramel as in like caramel flavor. I will admit, it tasted a little bit like caramel. They had some notes of anise that reminded me kind of like an absinthe almost, a light cinnamon note and clove, and a faint scent of orange oil, almost like you had expressed an orange peel, but not super duper sweet, not super duper noticeable. It was a very, very tasty rum to sip. I would say that spice rum compared to, let's say, at Captain Morgan, or even compared to stuff that I've made on my own, was probably the best spiced rum that I've ever had. It was very, very good. It was very, very clean. It felt like it was very true to the name of spiced rum and not spicy rum, if that makes sense at all. I really, really like that. And if I was able to pick up a bottle, this would have been my first pick, if not for the next rum that we tasted, which completely blew my mind out of the water. They have a dark grilled pineapple rum, which is exactly what it sounds like. And honestly, my mouth is watering just thinking about the flavor that I had in my mouth as we were sipping that. It was so unique. It was so tasty. And that was, I think, aside from the rye from Cape Charles that I didn't wind up picking up, this was the other biggest disappointment of the trip, and not being able to pick up an entire barrel of this grilled pineapple rum, which essentially what they do is they take the pineapples, they put it on the grill, and they quite literally grill the shit out of these things, and after they grill it, they put it in a barrel. And after they put it in the barrel, after a while, they will caramelize them, they'll drop them into rum barrels for 6 months at a time, sweeten it with caramel and simple syrup, and that's all you do. And that's how you make the grilled pineapple rum, which inspired in me an opportunistic feeling of, well, if they can grill pineapple and put it in rum for 6 months and put a little caramel into it, why can't I? So I feel very determined at some point, if somebody can hold me accountable to it, I want to get my hands on a pineapple, I'm going to get my hands on a grill, I'm going to grill the fuck out of those pineapples, I'm going to throw it into rum, and I want to see what the hell happens, because that was freaking delicious. I want to try that. Maybe make one of our own. I've made tepache before, which is a pretty cool pineapple thing. I've made pineapple water before. I kind of like pineapples. Who knew? Anyway, it was a very emotional experience there. I loved it. It was super duper tasty. It was really, really unique. It was something that if I could get my hands on a bottle of it, and I had all the money in the world, and I could go, there was no distance too great, I would go back down and I'd get it. But I have a full-time job and a very limited wallet. So maybe next year. And that was kind of the rising, that was the rising action, the climax, and we kind of come back down from there. They had three other rums that we were able to taste. They had a toasted coconut rum, which tasted really good. There's absolutely no coloring in it. It tastes very similar to simple syrup. because their toasted coconut rum actually has a lot of simple syrup in it. They add some natural toasted coconut flavor to it because evidently, and he was very honest about this, they have not gotten a method to get actual coconut flavor into the rum that they want from an actual coconut. So they've tried to roast it, they've tried to bake it, they've tried to infuse it, and just evidently they haven't found something that works to get that coconut flavor into the rum the way that, you know, would be the most natural way. He was making comparisons to Malibu. It tasted very similar to Malibu. It was a very Malibu, very coconut heavy, very much tasted like that sort of, what was it here? Light coconut flavor, like eating into a coconut with a little bit of the refreshing coconut water taste. When I sip Malibu, I don't get those refreshing coconut water sensations, those coconut water notes. I don't get that at all. It's very much like coconut in your face, coconut cream and oil. Although with this rum, it was a little more watery, and that's probably because of the presence of the extreme amounts of simple syrup in there, which completely sweetened the thing up. They also had their Island Rum Cream and their Bananas Foster Rum, which they both have. I want to say they were both the rum creams. The Bananas Foster kind of tasted like banana, just a little bit, and the rum cream uses caramel and 100% Georgia sweet cream, Tahitian vanilla, and they said it was really, really great in coffee, or combined with Hilton Head Island Distillery Espresso Rum using local beans and eggnog. It kind of tasted like eggnog. That and the other cream kind of tasted like eggnog. Apparently, they also do a special holiday rum and an eggnog rum around the same time. We didn't get to taste those, but if I had to go back for one bottle, it would be that grilled pineapple rum, because that was absolutely delightful. And so I feel like I've been talking a lot for the past, I don't even know how long or so, talking about distilleries that I didn't actually get to get bottles from, which disappoints me greatly. But, you know, it was a really, really big trip and we had to pack as much in as we could. We just couldn't make it there. I hope that at some point in the future, I'll be able to get a hand on those bottles. And if anybody out there is listening, Burnt Church or Hilton Head, I loved your spirits. I liked them a lot. And that is all I'm going to say on the topic there. But alas, we spent our time in South Carolina and unfortunately did not come out with any bottles from there. But we did take a variety of other trips around the island as well that I will very quickly go through. One of the other things that I really, really enjoy about my family vacations is ever since I first started getting into this kind of habit of mixology, even a little bit before then, I started getting really interested in the tastes that I can get from the world at large, whether that be in teas, whether that be in coffees, whether that be in spirits, alcohol, or otherwise. And there are a number of stores that you can go to on the island that you can get a lot of these provisions from, which is really, really cool. In particular, I want to shout out two particular locations down there on Hilton Head Island I go to every single year to fill up all of my stuff, to fill up my spice cabinet, to fill up my things of just oddities and whatnot that I get to eat, taste, and otherwise. One is A&M Provisions. I've talked with the owner a little bit there, and his whole shtick is going up and down the coast and trying to find places that sell stuff, whether that be coffees or hot sauces or bitters or meats or cheeses, you name it, and he sources them down there and puts that in his little shop of his. I don't think it's a small place, and I think they only have a little Facebook page, but I want to show them a lot of love because I go back to them every single year. That was the place where I got my first really cool bottle of bitters, which I think was the Woodford Reserve bitters and the Bitter Cube bitters and the Bitters Lab bitters, and since then I've been coming back every single year for coffee, for their bitters, for their beers that they sell there as well, that they source from local breweries and stuff. I love that place so much, and I don't go down there anymore without going to that place at least once, because I love it very much. The other place is down in a place called Caligny Plaza, and there is a place there called the Spice and Tea Exchange, which, oh my God, things are falling, provides so many different things. A couple of them have fallen off of the bar, but I'm gonna showcase a couple of things that I wound up grabbing this year that hopefully will make an appearance in some of the future streams going forward for the various other things that we have. I see Rich Note popping and saying, taking notes, about to spend next week in Hilton Head for my birthday. No kidding! Wow, very good to hear, Rich. I'm sure you will enjoy it. I hope it doesn't torrentially downpour on you like it kind of did for us, but we were hanging in our villa, so it was very, very nice. So let's see. Let me bring the cocktail angle over here. Let me put this down here so I can show you all the different provisions that we grabbed here. It's going to be a little difficult here. But so I'm going to lay these out here, and if anybody sees anything of interest, point them out, because I will share that with you. I will share that with you greatly. Of note, I think some things fell to the other side, so let me go. Oh my God, I need to have more of this stuff. Holy crap. I have a whole bag of this stuff. That's the logo, by the way. That's over in Caligny Plaza, for those who are taking notes. Something else fell in here. Oh, shoot, I'm falling over this. Oh my God. I mentioned we haven't quite unpacked yet, so I'm tripping quite literally all over the place. There's the other thing that we grabbed there. Nyana says, you beat me to it. Yeah, crazy. We're staying right near Caligny. Weather looks okay so far, just hot. I have particular memories of Hilton Head. It's the nostalgia, it's the family jovialness. It's very, very fun. And that sort of sticky, hot air is something that I've grown to love very, very much. And that makes for pina coladas by the pool, or the margaritas that are very shitty nowadays. I'm not very happy with the hotel right now. It makes them fitting, rather. But so we bought a number of things at the Spice and Chi Exchange. Anna and I go there every single year. I mostly go there every single year. We pick up stuff and whatnot. I'm trying to remember what it is that we got while we were there. Let's see. I have this box back here. I don't remember what's in it. It says, oh, this is a candle. So this is from Caligny. They have a cool wax shop down there where you can get candles that look like pretty much anything you want. And it's absolutely awesome. We got a number of different things. I'm just going to quickly run through this list. We have some cypress white sea salt. We got some mocha mushroom herbal tea. I'm planning a mushroom episode, more on that in a little bit. We have the Vicks garlic blend, which somebody I know in my life was like, you're gonna love this thing that I make because I use a special spice blend. And I was like, hypothetically speaking, if I said the phrase Vicks garlic fix, does that ring a bell to you? And they were like, how do you know that? That's the spice blend that I use in my meal. Somehow I was able to pick that out specifically, which was a very prideful moment for me. We have mint basil tea, which we picked up. What else did we have? We had this whole pack here that we picked up of sauteed mushroom spices. We had gourmet pepper spices. We have Tuscany spice blends. This is just me kind of nerding out all of this stuff. The things that I am very, very passionate about and things that I'm really excited for is that mocha mushroom tea that we found, as well as some of these other things here. I used some rose petals that I got from the Spice and Tea Exchange for that rhubarb and rose syrup that I literally can't shut up about. I got some more, naturally. We got this lavender, which there are places around here that I can get lavender at, but I just don't. So I picked up a bag of it while we were down there. Pink pepperberry? I've never heard of pepperberry before. It sounds really cool. A special type of cinnamon that I've never heard of before. It's not Ceylon, it's Corinthia. I don't know what that is. I like it very much. I picked it up because it sounded funny. Peach on the beach sugar. They sell different types of sugars. They sell sugars and salts and teas and spices and all that stuff. They also sold just bay leaves, which I'm a cocktail mixologist. Bay leaves are gonna come up every once in a while. And cardamom pods, which for some reason, when I needed these, I couldn't find them anywhere. So now we have them and they'll be used for custom things. In addition, there was one particular thing that I found that every time I go back to the Spice and Tea Exchange, I am looking for. And previously, when I first found it, I didn't buy it because I was afraid of potentially misusing it because it is an expensive little spice. This little vial, this is the only thing that they sell in a vial, is a little vial of saffron. And it is beautiful. It's Spanish saffron that I picked up from the Spice and Tea Exchange. I know a number of different recipes that I've cataloged in our recipe book about how to use saffron. And honestly, I'm intimidated. I don't want to use it wrong, but I have it now. So I feel like I have so much power in my hands. In particular, you can make a grenadine from this. You can make some cocktail called the Conditium Paradoxicum, which I have no idea what's in it, but it features saffron and a number of other recipes. Maybe if our benefactors love us very much, maybe we'll be able to do a whole saffron-themed stream, which would probably be the most lavish experience ever. And it also came in this cute little container, which I absolutely love, so. I love the Spice and Tea Exchange. Also, the people who work there are just so, so kind. The people who work at the Spice and Tea Exchange are very knowledgeable, they're very cordial, and they love to talk, and I love to talk as well, if that wasn't already evident. And so I cannot remember her name for the life of me, but you know who you are, and thank you very much for making that whole experience not embarrassing for buying all this spice and tea stuff. I really leaned into it this year, and I was very, very, very happy with it, and it was great. I don't have anything else from that particular part of the island, but it's great. OMG, I want that bottle. You can keep the saffron. It is the cutest little thing. It's so cute. I love it so much. And oh my God, I just remembered that I picked up another thing from Hilton Head and it's got nothing to do with anything consumable. And I'm just gonna see whether or not I can find it real quick. I'm not gonna say what it is because when you see it, you're gonna know why. If I can find it. If not, I will spoil it. I have no idea what it is. I'm gonna see if I can find it somewhere.
It's heavy, it's big, it's made of glass, and I have no idea where it is because we're not particularly unpacked yet, but I'm gonna go through some of the bags that are still here and see if I can find it. Yes, I am! I found it! I found it! Oh my gosh.
Y'all, this is freaking awesome. Hold on, let me bring the cocktail logo over. This is so beautiful. I found this. I'm not usually a gift shop kind of guy, but I was walking around the gift shop and I saw this in the midst of a bunch of other things, and I was like, I need to have this in my life. I need to have it. Oh my god. Oh, what is this? Oh, Hilton Head Distillery. This is a little recipe card they gave us. It's very cool. Check this out. It's a fish bottle, and it comes with a little, I don't know what you call that thing. It's a wheel, and it was $10. This bottle, to me, looks like a Swedish fish, and it, as soon as I saw this, I was like, I need to put grenadine in this. Wait.
Hold up a second. I have grenadine. Wait, I have a better idea. Oh, actually, I didn't clean this bottle. Okay, hold on. I haven't cleaned the bottle yet. I was gonna put the rhubarb and rose syrup in it. I'm not gonna do it. This bottle is unclean. This grenadine is like 2 years old. I need to make more anyways.
I absolutely bought the fish flask.
Then dilute it with water.
Then I can dilute it with water. We're doing this for color. This grenadine is, I don't know. This is gonna go in the wash afterwards. I want to see this look like a Swedish fish. This bottle needs to be cleaned. I'll put that in the bucket. Then let's put a little bit of, let's see how much water I can put in that. Let's see. Don't spill. All right, spill just a little bit. All right, we're continuing.
Oh, it's and like it's separating.
It's separating? No, it's not. It just needs a little bit of a, just needs a little bit of a shake. Oh, that's true. There is no cap. It notably did not come with a cap. Oh my god! It's fine. That's why we have one of these things. Where's the funnel? Hello.
Mark. See, look at how it sits on the bottom.
Ah! Well, I made a small mistake. That's okay. Shit happens around here. Anyway, this is my... Let's see if I can... Hold on a second.
You have a stirrer?
I have things that I can stir it with. Let's see, hold on a second. I'm gonna stick my thumb in the fish. Whoa!
You gotta clean that floor now.
Hold on, I'm sticking my thumb in the fish.
That's a horrible decision. You haven't cleaned that bottle.
I know I didn't clean the bottle, but here we are. Oh, here's a Catan coaster we picked up at Gen Con. It's my fish. And are you proud of my fish? It's not a Swedish fish per se, but it is a fish.
It is definitely a dark red fish.
It's my fish. You fingered the fish? What? I'd kiss the fish too if it weren't so dirty. But I have a fiance and she might get dirty. I did! I fingered the fish, y'all! I fingered the fish! And now it's all red. I think I done messed up, y'all. Anyways, that grenadine is hopeless now, so I'm gonna put that away and move on with my life, knowing that I fingered the fish. It's just a bit, y'all. It's just a bit. That's all it is. It's just a bit. Anyways, I love that bottle. I completely forgot about that bottle until just now, so I'm happy for it. Also, going back to the other pieces of Burnt Church Distillery a little bit, they did provide these cards that Anna pulled out of the bag. They also do non-alcoholic spirits too. They had a grapefruit basil. They had a blueberry ginger mint. They had a lemon cucumber serrano, which notably all had their own special type of spice, because if it's a non-alcoholic spirit, it's trying to emulate alcohol, and it did an okay job. And we had all the other spirits that I mentioned, a couple of them. I probably wasn't supposed to take these, but I did. This is the, if somebody wouldn't mind doing a exclamation point photo for me, because I have all my hands on this. I want to be able to categorize this photo for later, and I would greatly appreciate it. These are all the things from Burnt Church Distillery, and I hope I got all of the names on there. That's the kind of thing. There was the Sippin' Saint, Burt Church Vodka, they had their Devil's Elbow and whatnot, it was all the stuff on there. Palmel Stretch, Rye Whiskey, Bluffton American Whiskey, Anita's Choice, Sippin' Saint, Burt Church, they had a pair of vodka, that was the cool one, they had a pair of vodka, and I loved that a lot. Anyways, putting that away. So I wasn't able to come away with a bottle, but I was able to come away with a bit of cards. Thank you very much for that, Rye, I really appreciate it. So, that was the first leg of our journey. I'm an hour and a half into this, and I'm obviously not done with this yet. I am having a very good time reflecting on the trip that we took. It was very, very fun. It was a really, really fun road trip. And I'm so glad that we got to take things back with us. That was the best part about it, the fact that you're able to come back and bring some things with us. Not only the actual physical bodies, but the the bottles, but also the stories along there with them. So let's regroup for a second. Oh! There's one more part of that journey that I almost forgot about, and that is Savannah, Georgia. We also visited Savannah, Georgia, and we do, I think, at least once a year down there. There's a little area that we go to eat at. They have an ice cream parlor, they have a candy parlor, and they have these outdoor shops that you can buy stuff at, and I'm trying to remember what it is that I bought from those shops around. You can buy weed gummies there. I didn't buy weed gummies this year. I'm just not into that recently. However, I was able to find... Ooh, where is it? Where is it? I'm trying to remember where I put it. It's a bag of fun stuff that I was just alluding to before, and I don't know where it is. It's okay. I don't know where it is. That's all right. So there was this little stand down there, and I don't remember what it was called, but they were selling steel rings, and they were also selling mushrooms. Not like mushrooms that looked like they were picked up of the thing. It was like powdered mushroom that they get from a distributor or something. So I had a wonderfully long conversation with somebody about mushrooms, specifically cordyceps. They were also selling lion's mane and chaga, I believe, and there were two other types as well that I can't quite articulate on, and I got a whole bit of science about mushrooms and how it does to do the body good and various resources and distributors for stuff. I don't know where the bag is, but I picked up a bag of cordyceps, which is, according to one universe, makes people into zombies. According to this universe, freeze the mind, I suppose. Not in like a high kind of way, just kind of is good nutrients for the body. So you may have caught the mushroom tea that I pulled out from the spice and tea exchange, and I'm mentioning the cordyceps, which again, I can't seem to find right now. I thought I had it, but it's just a green bag. I wasn't gonna open it up. But I do have aspirations to do a whole mushroom theme as well. And so we'll get to that at some point. That sounds like it'd be a lot of fun, potentially too much fun. Miamma says that we're headed to Savannah as well, which is great. I think we ate at a restaurant called, I'm trying to remember what it was. For the sake of your journey, I'm going to figure out what that was because I can't remember what it was. It's probably a part of my story archive. Let me check that real quick. Anna showed me how to check my story archive. I didn't exactly know how to do that. Saved. No, not saved. Archive. Go to my archive. I mentioned the place that we ate at, and what was it? We ate at. I'm gonna get this for you. Did I not write it down? I must have written it down. I must have. I cannot believe it. Oh, B. Matthews Eatery. That's where we ate at. They have an excellent brunch. I think I had the crab cake while I was there. B. Matthews Eatery. What the B stands for, I literally have no idea, but they did have multiple paintings of bees and stuff at the establishment, but B is not spelled B-E-E. It's just the letter B. So I hope that the B stands for B. Otherwise, I'm confused for you, Matthew. What is your obsession with bees? Also, they have good cocktails in the evening. They close in the middle of lunch and then they reopen for dinner, and that's why they serve their full cocktail menu. They also do mimosas, and to be honest, the mimosa really wasn't that good in my opinion. I can make a better mimosa, which really isn't saying that much. But it was good, and we enjoyed the food that was there. The crab cake was nice. And they also did, I think they did like fried pickles or something, which personally I very much appreciate. In any case, that's really all I have for there, except for this other bottle that I picked up at one of the stores that we were down there, specifically the next bottle of the evening. It's finally about time that we get back to the spirits part of the road trip, which is something that is sourced from Virginia. Specifically, is this Savannah? This is specifically Savannah, Georgia. So the bottle that we have is this distillery called Ghost Coast. And while I was there at the liquor store, I've gone here, I think, once a year for the past 2 years now at the same liquor store. It's... I'm gonna find the liquor store too, because we're on this topic. It was... River Street Liqueur. River Street Liqueur is where I get this. I usually get my bottle every year. I have gone in every year so far for the past 2 years and said, I'm looking for something from Georgia. I'm trying to taste the taste of Georgia. What bottle do you recommend? Last year, I got this Savannah, Georgia bourbon, which again, I went through too fast to truly appreciate. But this year, I got this Ghost Coast, which was probably the most expensive bottle that I grabbed throughout this journey. And the reason why I spent the cash on it was because of the tale that was spun for me, which may or may not be true in a way. I might've just fallen for something, but I think it was a pretty good whiskey purchase. So apparently Ghost Coast Distillery was one of those distilleries that didn't really make it through the pandemic. They had been making like award-winning spirits for a number of years, and then because of the conflict of the pandemic, had to close their doors down. Evidently, they've gone through, I think, a bottle redesign, and this is one of the original bottles that they had from, I guess, their first round of this particular whiskey, their Master Straight Bourbon Whiskey, 43% alcohol by volume, the Ghost Coast one. Now, the bottle has apparently changed over time, and the gentleman at the liquor store pulled out this bottle and was like, you'll notice that this one is different than the rest. This is their old bottle design. Because it is their old bottle design, this is probably the oldest bottle of the whiskey that we happen to sell here. And I was like, cool, is it good? Do you have tasting notes? And I think they gave me tasting notes, and I fell for it. I was like, I didn't fall for it. I saw it, I heard the description, and I was like, I really want to buy this bottle of whiskey. My other choice was a $30 bottle of Georgia Peach Vodka, and I like the idea of that, but this sounded just so much more appetizing. So, here it goes. I think I did try a little bit of this, and I wasn't really in the right state of mind, the right space to truly appreciate it, which I think is a general thing with spirits tasting. I find, like with a lot of other things, like maybe you're walking through the park or you're going through a museum, I feel like you gotta get yourself in the right state of mind to really open yourself up to the flavors, the experience, the interpretations. People will say like certain wines taste like wood or certain whiskeys taste like herbs. And honestly, if you think about it from a very, like, super, like, a very top-level perspective, no, this does not taste like cherries. No, it does not taste like cinnamon. It's not even remotely tasting like cinnamon. But there are some aspects of some of these spirit tastings where it does kind of remind you of a cinnamon or a clove or a honey. It does kind of remind you of the taste of wood or forest floor and stuff. And if you have those sort of flavor comparisons, you can make them. Some people's relative memories or relative like sense of taste or smell is not as proficient as others, which is the beauty of our taste and whatnot being subjective, which I think is kind of cool. But that's the kind of experience you can open yourself up to. When I opened this bottle the first time, I'll admit, I was not really in a good state of mind. I took a little sip of it and I didn't fully appreciate it. So now I was hoping that during this time here, we'll be able to really go into it with a full open mind to really open ourselves up to the flavors and see what kind of story it's trying to spin for us and what kind of experience we will get at the other side. It's a very emotional journey, he says, who's been drinking, I guess, pieces of spirits for almost 2 hours now. I don't need too much of it. This one here, from what I recall, is a sipping whiskey. I certainly don't think that I would be putting this in cocktails. However, maybe as I get more experience with the nuances of whiskey bourbons and otherwise, maybe we will find a use for that at some point. So, let's see. And apparently, there was the app that the individuals at the store used to get tasting notes on this Ghost Coast, and I don't exactly remember what it was, and I probably should have asked while I was there, but I'm sure that there are apps out there specifically for, like, getting notes on your whiskey, just like there are notes on your beer, or notes on your wines and stuff. Beer, I go to Untappd, and wine, I use this app called Vivino. Cocktails, I don't really have anything for that. I go to this place called Crafted Pour, but people aren't really providing tasting notes, they're just providing recipes. It's hard to tell what's good and what's not. They do have a rating system on there, but I don't think anybody uses it right now. And then on the other side of things, what is it, for the spirits and stuff, I think there's probably a bourbon app out there, but I don't know about it. So, let's pop ourselves into this for a little bit of an experience. Or at least I'll try to explain it as much as I possibly can using the words that I have been provided by a dictionary, probably. So right off the bat, very, very potent smell. This is coming in at, it's not even the most alcoholic whiskey that I have here. This is only 86 proof here, but for some reason, this smell is super duper permeated. It is like flaring up my nostrils very powerfully. It's a very, very powerful smell, but, excuse me. I can feel it in my mouth a little bit. I'm not a master at this either, but it does, I could say it does kind of smell, it almost smells like a beach. There's something sandy about it, almost like a briny, cool coast air. Now, that is not because it says Ghost Coast on the side there. That association between the coast and otherwise was not in my mind when I made that statement. Although it might seem that way that I'm pulling this out of thin air. And the air is not exactly that thin. It's actually quite humid. Savannah, Georgia. Kind of humid. The coast, kind of humid when you're near the water. But there is something about that that almost does remind me of a sandy beach and driftwood. Something that seems almost a little more humid, a little more musty, but still oddly warm and inviting in a way. Very intoxicating, might I add, because it smells like booze naturally. Let's see what kind of taste we get without any sort of drip drop in it. Very spice forward, very bitter, but in all the good ways. I'll break that down for in a second. It is, I would say, when I describe something as very spice forward, sometimes rye comes to mind, like a rye spice, which to me translates to something that's a little more cinnamony, a little more clovey, a little more Christmas spicy. This is not that kind of spice. This is a poignant spice that reminds me more of like cardamom or something different than that, at least. It's not quite rye spice. It's more like, I guess cardamom comes to mind. It's so interesting. And a little bit of that clove aspect too. In addition to that, there is a certain bitterness there that does not remind me of the bitterness of biting into cinnamon or biting into clove or sipping on some nog that's gone way too bad. It's a bitterness that reminds me of chocolate, like deep cocoa. This to me has strong notes of cardamom spice and cocoa right off the bat, which is honestly something that I, so far in my whiskey journey, have not gotten from a bottle. This is a very, very unique bottle taste, kind of like how the Sagamore rye, to me at least on my first taste of it, had like these notes of honey, which I had never gotten from a whiskey before. This is a flavor that, at least in a whiskey, at least a piece of it, I have not gotten previously. It's a spice forwardness that is very, it reminds me of chocolate. Reminds me of chocolate. Very, very chocolatey. I would even say that even talking through this right now, it's almost as if I took a bite of like powdery chocolate and that flavor is still dissipating in my mouth. Now, with that in mind, I'll add a little bit of water to this, which I have to fill myself back up on. We're gonna add a little bit of water, a little bit of lukewarm water to this to open up some of those more sweeter, poignant, fruity components and see how this is going to transform a bit, if it really transforms at all. I'll try that. A little bit of water drop, my finger, give it a little finger test, give it a little bit of a swirl, trying to update the palate a little bit and see what happens. Now, instead of it being more coasty, this is reminding me of a forest. This is reminding me of woody trees with a little bit of smoke, honestly. There is the slightest tinge of smoke. Exactly what kind of smoke, I don't really know. It smells like a wood is on fire. It smells like a forest that might be one of those, there's a word for it, and I don't know what the word are, but it's for the forests that regulate themselves by burning themselves to the ground and then regrowing up from them. Coniferous is not the right word, I don't think, but there is a word similar to that that describes those types of forests. That's the impression I'm getting now. It's also very, like, it's very, like, leafy in a way, which is weird to describe. It's almost like you're smelling like, almost like a, almost evergreeny in a way. It's really, really weird. But I like it. Excuse me. Something, I had a taste in there. What was that? I think I was tasting dinner a little bit, which is kind of chicken-y. It's a little bit more cocoa-y now. It's actually less on the cocoa than it is on caramel notes. Notes of caramel and toffee. Like if you've ever had a Heath bar, actually, if you've ever had a Heath bar with just chocolate and toffee, if you took the chocolate and made it a bit more dark, and you took the toffee and sweetened it up, I guess a bit less because it's whiskey, but a bit more in a certain other kind of way, that's what I would describe that as. Those sort of more woody notes, it's just like, there's a lot to, it's interesting, there is a lot to unpack here, which I don't know if maybe, again, I am only a couple years into this. I am by no means a pro. I am very much a novice, and I fully admit to that. But maybe it's the price of the bottle that's talking. This was like an $80 bottle of whiskey. And maybe it was the sales that actually kind of got my mind going there. And the thing that I see on the bottle, I'm like, so... I love it. I would say that for this particular purchase of bottle here, I took a bit of a gamble with it, and I don't regret it. I think this is going to be a very, very nice sipping whiskey that I can enjoy on the off days every once in a while. Or maybe it pops up in a cocktail sometime. I'm not super sure. I look forward to trying it. I see Steel 40707 say, hi, Cammy. Hi, Cammy. See ya. Yo, what's up there? Stell? Stelly? Steel? Stell? Thrill? Shell, maybe? I like that. Welcome to the Bar with an X. I'm giving giving details of my road trip, which I have a strange feeling that you are already aware of based off of what I've just read there. But you can dox yourself if you want to. I will not be doing the job for you. Welcome here. Sorry, it's Emily from vacation. Ah, you did it. That's okay. I got the idea. Hello, Emily. Good to see you. Goop. That's okay. That's okay. Nobody else knows who you are. I know who you are. I know a lot of people are out here. However, that's because, you know, evidently we get a little personal around here. We're all drinking together sometimes. Sometimes. Anyway, this was the Ghost Coast that I would have picked up in Savannah while we were down there on vacation. I'm actually just at the end of that particular part of our journey, and we'll be moving on to the next part of the journey, which nobody out there who is a part of that particular leg got to see because we left it for greener pastures. So we'll be moving on after that. But that was the final thought on this Ghost Coast here is it's very pleasant. It's very complex, and I feel like I have a bit of an issue going out there saying that this is a complex whiskey, because I feel like to me all whiskeys are complex, but this has been the most down-to-earth appreciable whiskey that I would call complex because of just the sheer quantity of flavors that I was able to get to it within the first two or three sips of it, which I think is very appreciable. It doesn't really matter in the grand scheme of things. So long as I feel good about the purchase that I made with my money that I'm still paying back the credit card debt on, I think we're going to be just fine. In any case, we'll clean out a little snifter glass here and we'll move on to another spirit. We're going to move on to a completely different part of our journey. We actually have completed speaking about the first leg of the journey. To be fair, just to give you an idea, we're about 2 hours in so far. The next leg of the journey is going to be the next big one, and then the final leg of the journey is just it's a smaller one. We shouldn't be there for very long, just to give you an idea of what's left of here. But that's what I'm doing. I'm giving a full recollection of what mine and Anna's last week was in terms of our vacation and our bit of a road trip. We went from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, down to Hilton Head Island, South Carolina, making a couple of stops along the way. From Hilton Head, South Carolina, up to Indianapolis, Indiana, making a couple of stops along the way. And then from Indianapolis, back through Ohio and Pennsylvania, back to our homestead here in Philadelphia, where The Bar with an X is filmed every Wednesday at 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern Standard Time. If you're into this kind of content, this is the part of the show where I'll say I do this every single Wednesday. There's a blog that comes out of this and a couple of short form videos as well. And if you'd like to stick around for it, now would be that would be the call to action. If you're not, or you're just sitting here for the ride, I just want to say my appreciation to you and that for this brief moment that we were able to exist in this life together, thank you for that. And may you have a very merry rest of your way. Rye pops in here and says, how much did you spend in tolls? Rye, I don't look at the tolls. I will admit the easy pass that is in our car is paid off by Anna's father, so I never see those bills, which I'm very thankful for. However, there was at least a leg of our journey that combined with all the easy pass tolls, I think was at least, oh my God, it had to be at least $50. Oh my God, traveling is expensive. Kid standing out here saying, cheers, my friend. Cheers, my friend. Let's put this bottle away and continue the next part of my journey. What I'm actually going to do real quick is I am feeling hot under the collar because I'm behind the camera and this hat is on and just doing my head up here. I'm gonna turn the air on a little bit more.
It gets a little cold downstairs, but I don't think Anna's gonna be mine too much. Get down. There we go. I'll turn the air on just for a little bit. Nobody will hear any of it. It'll be fine. You
won't even notice. It's like the air isn't even on. It's purely for my benefit, not for yours. And I probably didn't need to mention it at all. But for the sake of full transparency, we like to be honest around here. Disney Queen says, which trip? Trip? What do you mean, which trip? I don't really know what you're talking about. The trip that I just took over to the thermostat to make it a little cooler in here. Shall we move on to the next leg of our journey? Where is my remote? Here is my remote. Zoom in on my face. Just kidding, it's not really my face. It's the map. The map. The map. The map. The map. On the map. On the map. On the map. Where's the dowel of discipline? Here's the dowel of discipline. Now, using the dowel of discipline, I'm going to use this as the dowel of education to tell you all where we went next. So we went from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, all the way down to Hilton Head, South Carolina, where we had some trips through Maryland. We pick up a bottle of Sagamore whiskey. We stopped somewhere along the lines in North Carolina to pick up a bottle of Conniption gin. Somewhere in Virginia, we found ourselves near Cape Charles, but that was a different trip entirely. We found our way down to South Carolina, where we tested a number of different bottles from Burt Church Distillery and Hilton Head Distillery, and we stopped in Savannah, Georgia to pick up that bottle of Ghost Coast Distillery, which is no longer was a Ghost Coast does not make whiskey anymore. They were bought out by, I think they closed their doors and all of their inventory was sold to somebody else. Whether or not that bottle of whiskey taste is going to exist out in the world again, I have literally no idea. If anybody has more context on that than I do, please feel free to share. I am very, very interested. I see Disney Queen saying, I think it was 7 to 11 for the first one, and totals in the triangle was about $22 to $32, if I remember it properly. Disney Queen keeps track of that better than I do, so I appreciate that, dears, very much. So the next leg of our journey found us traveling through South Carolina, up through a little bit of North Carolina, passing through Tennessee and Kentucky, through Bourbon County country, all the way up to Indianapolis, where we went to a convention called Gen Con. Now, I will walk you through those journeys. We stopped at one distillery. Actually, there was a number of distilleries that we stopped at on this particular trip here. We stopped at a distillery in North Carolina, Two Trees Distillery. We stopped at a distillery in Tennessee, specifically Knoxville Whiskey Works. And we stopped at a liquor store in Kentucky. All the distilleries and stuff were closed, where we picked up a bottle of authentic Kentucky bourbon, supposedly the best in the realm. And then when we got up to Indiana, well, we bought a bottle of stuff there as well and attended a board game convention, which I will give some details on as well. The exciting part of our trip, where I have plenty of goodies to share. I'm not going to be able to get through all the Gen Con stuff, although I will highlight a couple of things that I do want to share. There was just so much that happened during that, and honestly, I am kind of running. I can understand the time constraint that I'm putting myself on. So a more in-depth recollection of what happened at Gen Con, I can totally talk about it at some point in time if somebody reminds me of it. There was so much that happened there, but I can get into that other times. Rye says, I'm headed to bed. Glad you enjoyed your trip. Thank you so very much, Rye. Thank you for popping in for a spell, and I hope your rest is restorative, as it should be for all of us, even when it's sometimes not. So, we will move on to the next part of the trip, which was going from South Carolina up to Indianapolis, where we first stopped at a place called Two Trees Distillery. Two Trees Distillery was a place where we tasted a number of different spirits. We were actually greeted very happily by a dude named Terry as we stopped on our journey. I'm gonna take a quick bit of water real quick because I'm getting a little dry over here. Brad popping in here with the 11 months. Dude, we're almost a year old with this. Brad has been around here. He gave us that bottle of Conniption that we were tasting earlier, and was also a wonderfully, wonderful guest when we did that whole chartreuse stream of ours circa, I don't know, a couple of months ago. I love that man so much. I'm glad that he's in our life. Also, hi, we lost baseball. That's okay. That's why we have whiskey, isn't it? That's why we have gin. That's why we have drinks to enjoy even the lower moments of our lives. But so Two Trees Distillery was this place that Anna kind of found off the beaten path. When we walked in there, there was nobody there. There was nobody there, and we walked to the bar and just kind of sat down, and somebody, we could see the whole distillery through these glass pane windows, and we see somebody's head poke up, somebody else's head turn, and somebody came to us. There was a gentleman named Terry who walked us through the process that we tasted. Now, I have a collection of tasting notes from Two Trees Distillery. We tried, I think, a total of 10 of their spirits. That was the part of the journey where I took a sip and then pushed it away because I wasn't going to drink all of it because there was driving left in the trip, and I needed to keep my wits about me for the rest of the journey as we drove through the bottom part of the Appalachian Mountains. Now, we got to try a number of different spirits, and I have all those tasting notes, and I honestly don't know where they are because we're still not completely unpacked yet, so I won't be able to give a full recollection of those, but we tried a number of their different whiskeys. We tried a number of their different sweetened whiskeys, as well as, I believe, two different types of vodkas, and there's a special little bit of information that I found out while I was there, which I'll expand upon in just a hot second. Brad says, that is why we have drinks for highs and for lows, for celebrations and for sorrow. It's just the beautiful, this little space in between that we exist in as humans. I think that's beautifully poetic. But so Two Trees was cool in the sense that Two Trees is cool because, at least according to what I see, what they told me, is they have a special process for rapid maturation. I'll break that down for you. Rapid means quick. Maturation is just the process by which things mature. Maturation, if you will. That just sounds weird to me, so I don't say it that way. They have this apparatus, this patented technology that allows them to take a whiskey that would be aged in a matter of 2 or 3 years and get it aged in 24 hours, a single day, using their machine, which has numbers as a name, I think. Very, very interesting. An oldening machine, if you will, says Brad. Now, evidently, their technology utilizes a combination of heat, pressure, and various other characteristics of our physical world to imbue the flavor of various different types of wood into the whiskey. Instead of this whiskey sitting in a barrel for 2+ years, instead they take these wooden logs of, I think it was white oak, and they roast them in an oven. And they get them real nice and blackened and charred. Then they wood chip it, and they throw it into the whiskey base and put it into the machine, and within 24 hours, it's ripped out a lot of those flavors of char and cinnamon and oak and other stuff, I'm sure, because they would know more about that than I do. It's their product that kind of makes sense. Oh, I can see the horribly embarrassing, not embarrassing, that circular nightmare emoji or emote of my matured Cameron. That's what happens when I sit in a barrel for too long. When you put me in a barrel and you spin me down, I don't know, let's say, what's that big waterfall that exists in Canada? Niagara Falls, when they do the barrel down in Niagara Falls. That's what I look like. Maybe, for instance. But so, a lot of their whiskeys are made using that rapid maturation process, which they've patented. Apparently, people come from wherever to give them their own spirits and say, hey, we would like to pay you to use your machine to mature our spirits for us, which is very, very interesting. Apparently, they were on, like, I think season 4 of Moonshiners, I believe, because the original maker of Two Trees Distillery was actually a moonshiner. He made his moonshine, he figured out the whole maturation process, and then many, many years later, they expanded into more broad markets like flavored spirits and whatnot, like this candy apple flavored whiskey that I have right here. Niagara Falls, Negroni Falls, me going down the Negroni Falls. It's my favorite drink. I like that stuff greatly. No Negronis tonight. All spirit tasting, and not all the spirit. That would make work very unenjoyable tomorrow. Oh yeah, you can't drive on toll roads here or anywhere. No, I'm not a fan of it. No tolls. None of that. So we tried a number of different bottles. One of the other things that I thought was interesting is that Two Trees Distillery has this collection of folklore-based spirits based off of the folklore of the Appalachian Mountains, which while I was there, I was informed that it's pronounced Appalachian, not Appalachian. The area is called Appalachia, but the mountains are called Appalachia. I just gotta take the locals' word for it, so that's what I'm using now. Just like when I learned how to say orgeat correctly. Not orgeat, not orgeat, not orgeat, orgeat. I learned from the locals. The person said that they were from France. I have to believe them on that.
You just trusted some random person on the internet.
Of course I trust random people on the internet. I trust everybody out there. That's why Brad's got that little sword next to his name, because I apparently trust him too. So they had four different bottles of whiskey that were a part of their folklore series that I think one of them, I don't remember what the folklore things was. One was a pipe smoking giant. One was like a wombat type thing. And there were two other type of, I guess, local folklore things as well. And I don't remember what any of their names are, but I'm sure it's probably on their website. I didn't take a picture of my tasting sheet, otherwise I would go through that. They have a number of different spirits, and I love the whole, like, folklore blending that they have on that. I think it's absolutely beautiful. Hi, Anna, says Brad. What French word is that? Orgeat, I don't think is actually a French word, but orgeat is a combination of almond milk as well as a little bit of amaretto and other spices and things such as orange blossom water that is used very heavily in tiki cocktails and various other things as well. It's usually very milky white, has a nice airy characteristic of it, and because of the amaretto and almond milk, or fresh almond milk or otherwise, can taste a little nutty, and it's great. Brad says, next time I'm going to Asheville, I'm going to drag Aaron to Fletcher. Tell me about it. Feel free to share your experiences in the Discord so we can all be a part of that journey and live vicariously through you, because we all want to experience the finer things in life, which the two of you happen to frequent the finer things in life. So let's see, Anna's favorite out of our Two Trees Distillery trip was this candy apple whiskey, which she found very, very, very tasty. And that, it seems, when I've been sharing it with other people as well, has also been a bit of a favorite because it's just very unique, a flavor that you wouldn't necessarily think would taste as good as it does. Based off of my recollection, this is exactly what it sounds like. It is candy and it is apple. As I opened up this container, the one that, like, the notes that I get is, oh, Anna's doing a little bit of unpacking right now, and one of the other things that I missed from our Hilton Head discussion was at A&M Provisions, I picked up this little bottle of bourbon barrel aged sorghum. Sorghum is another grain. I think it's that type of grass that you can get for sugar and stuff, and this kind of tastes like molasses. That'll probably show up on an ingredient stream going forward as we probably make a sorghum spirit. But this is our candy apple liqueur. This smells like a candy apple. Like, I'm back here, I open up the bottle, I put it back on. Excuse me. It smells like a candy apple. There's no other way around it. I also picked up some coffee. I'm just throwing things at you. Anna's just throwing things at me. Would you mind putting them on the table? I would greatly appreciate that. Just so I don't have too much space over here. No, I'll keep this over here for now. You're good, you're good. No, you don't have to take all this stuff. I'm not asking you to put it on the bar or take it over there.
I'm trying to figure out where my wallet is.
You're totally good. Anna may have lost her wallet or otherwise. Anna, how would you describe the candy apple whiskey?
It tastes like if you'd like to. So, think of like sugar. Think of like a sugary apple syrup or some kind of like candy apple based thing.
Mm-hmm.
That comes in first. Then you get this like slow heat. You get a tinge of whiskey, but it ends with like a light burn that doesn't have a remainder of whiskey flavor. That's how I describe it. Kind of like carnival.
Everybody claps for Anna on that beautiful description. Yeah. We're not being condescending. We are trying to validate each other here.
Oh, is that what it is?
Yes, absolutely. I would say, in my own interpretation, it kind of smells like a caramel Werther's original, and it tastes like candy. Candy apple, like the sugary part of the candy apple. Not a caramel apple, a candy freaking apple. And like that taste that you get in your mouth after you bite into like a Red Delicious, that flavor permeates. Like, this has a very prominent apple aftertaste that I've experienced from eating Red Delicious apples, which I don't really do very often because honestly, I'm not actually a big fan of apples. That's not really my favorite fruit to consume. I love bananas and avocados as my favorite fruits. Brad says, no, I'm just like, yay, Anna is on stream. Yay, for sure. No, you're not the condescending one. I was making a joke there. It didn't land very well.
Cameron, why are you being rude to your viewers?
I admit that I can be rude sometimes. Maybe it's the... I blame it on the alcohol, baby.
What?
What?
Why are you attacking this over here?
I don't know. You can do whatever you want to. Boo! Boo Cameron, yay Anna. Dude, that's how I sometimes feel.
That's so sad. You're poor people.
Anyway, as you may expect one to do, I am not going to sip the rest of this. We'll move on to something else. It's very nice. It's a very, very nice liqueur, and it's very unique on its flavor too, that like, I'm trying to think of how well that would go in things. Also, yay Cameron. Oh, thanks Brad. Warm fuzzy feelings. That's definitely not just coming from the alcohol. This would go great in coffee. I didn't actually try it in coffee yet, but this feels like it would go great in it. Like, I would agree with that. Yeah. It sweetens it up and makes it a little more, it makes it very, very sweet, and it's got that apple-y note to it. But what else goes well with... Ooh, this would probably go great in apple cider, too. Just because of the whole apple aspect of it all. In terms of that, other flavor ideas for candy apple whiskey I'm totally open to. I'm even thinking of like a candy apple like Boulevardier, where instead of just using like a base whiskey, you just use this instead and everything would get really, really sweet. That sounds like it would be really, really tasty.
Well, take a Midori drink.
Take a Midori drink. That's an idea. That's a good idea. And I was suggesting that instead of using a Midori, which is also a very, very sweet spirit liqueur, and you swap it out with this stuff instead and see what happens. Maybe add a hint of something else apple-y, like an apple liqueur or even like some crown apple. Some apple whiskey as well. Brad says, did I tell you about purple gin thing I had on Monday, which was the Durham gin in a French 75, but they also added rosemary? No. You didn't. Tell me more. And if you want, you can put exclamation point suggest next to it so I get a message about it so I don't forget. Mulled cider, but it's candy apple whiskey instead. That is an excellent idea. I love that. It's definitely a French 75. I love purple drinks. Purple drinks are great. I don't have any creme de, creme de violet or creme de cassis that goes in a French 75. I've never had any of that. But they use the Durham gin, specifically this Conniption gin from Durham, North Carolina. That sounds delightful. So it's basically just the Durham gin with champagne, I guess, right? And a little bit of rosemary. That sounds tasty. I like that. French 75 is gin, lemon, champers, and simple. Okay. What am I getting mixed up? I get French 75 mixed up with a Cure Royale. Cure Royale is the other one. That's the other one I was thinking of. Very nice. All right. So as we passed our way through, North Carolina and made our way to Tennessee, we started finding ourselves in Bourbon Country. Bourbon Country, Tennessee, Bourbon Country, Kentucky. I like whiskey. Whiskey is nice. And honestly, I felt very much out of my comfort zone over there. I figured there was an expectation, right, to go to Bourbon Country, go to Whiskey Country, and get, like, whiskey or get some bourbon. And I was like, well, I've got all this bourbon and whiskey that I picked up elsewhere. Why would I do what everybody else is doing? So the next stop on our journey was in Knoxville, Tennessee, where we went to the Knoxville Whiskey Works, and I didn't walk away with whiskey at all. I did taste some whiskey, but I did not walk away with any. And I do have some tasting notes on the bottles that I was able to taste there. Let me go pull those up real quick. I see Yay Durham from Kid out there. You're thinking of an Aviation or a Cure Royale. Durham is the best. Next time you're here, you're staying overnight, and we're taking you to all the bourbon spots, by the way. And I am both excited and slightly intimidated by that. Overall, a very happy and a very positive feeling. And I look forward to it nonetheless. Let me find the notes that I had on Knox Whiskey Works. I had notes on two different flights that I got there. I got their gin vodka flight and I got their whiskey flight there. And I walked away with two gins, which I will expand upon in a moment when I go through the other stuff. They have a number of different spirits that they have here. They do vodkas, they do gins, they do cordials and stuff. They do, an espresso cordial or espresso something. And of course they do whiskey. They are Whiskey Works after all, and apparently they know what they're doing over there, which is why their gins are really, really cool, and those are the bottles that I walked away with. Of note, I'll go through these tasting notes really, really quickly, and then we'll actually taste some of these bottles over here. Brad says I should be scared. I will remember nothing. That is a threat, sir, and we take those. So what I was able to taste at Tennessee Whiskey Works with a lovely conversation. It was also just me, Anna, and the bartender who was there. We had a lovely conversation with them. It was a very that's one of the things that I really like about just kind of being in those personal spaces where I guess alcohol or substances are involved, where the inhibitions flow like kind of dull down a little bit. Naturally, nobody there was drunk, because I was taking sips of everything and then tossing out the rest of it, and the bartender wasn't drinking on the job, and Anna was existing in her usual, I'm only gonna touch a little bit way. But the same kind of prospects of those intimate moments still apply there, and it was lovely to be able to be there with lovely company. So, the Knox flavors that I was able to try was, first and foremost, their Tennessee Valley Vodka, which kind of tasted like sanitizer. Not very smooth, I didn't really like it. Their Orange Vodka, which kind of tasted like an orange creamsicle, but without the sickle. More so on the orange, a little bit on the cream side, but no sickle. There was a bit of a bite afterwards, but it kind of reminded me of a sweet orange. I was eating some mandarin oranges this morning, those little tiny ones, and I got one as it was a little sour, and it reminded me of that vodka from the Knox Whiskey Works.
I just found my wallet.
Anna found her wallet. Yay! Here's for proper identification. We take those. They also had three different gins that we tried. One was their Jackson Park Avenue gin, which is their normal gin. It has a very pleasant floral bite to it, and it's the base for the other two gins, which I happened to pick up and am very excited to share with y'all. There is this...
I just found my non-dice!
Anna found her non-dice. Oh, her... what is it? Tiger's Eye dice?
Tiger's Eye. Yellow Tiger's Eye.
Whoa, these feel so good.
They don't have numbers on them.
ASMR, anybody? Yeah, there's no numbers on them.
Yeah, no.
That's okay. They're just polyhedral. I love
they're
that.
They're gonna go on our, like, wedding table.
Nice.
That's my decision.
Proper identification, says M. Yes, indeed. The sparkle, right, sparkle, sparkle. No, that's okay. Anna tends to interrupt things, but it's the part of this flair of being in a room with your partner, whom you love very much. And despite the chaos, continue to love very much. So...
what does that imply here?
I love you.
I found your weird rogue rock thingy.
Huh?
Remember the egg?
Oh, I picked up a small little opalescent rock that for some reason I thought I felt drawn to, and then they said, it's man-made, and I was like, cool, I hate you.
That's so mean.
I tried to open my spirit up to the stores of one of the Hilton Head Island places that we went into, the Black Mineral Shop, and I felt like I was kind of looked at like I was, I don't know, I felt kind of condescended too. That's okay, not all experiences can be positive. Maddie says hi!
Hi, Maddie.
Kami X says hi back. So let's see, the two gins that I have here, very, very exciting. One is pink, one is not so pink, one is brown, one is, it's kind of orange to be honest. Actually, you can be the judge of this. What color are these? Like the actual gin itself. I would say that this looks more orange despite it being the pink one, and this looks a little more pink on the other side because of the comparison between this. This bottle kind of looks like a watermelon from here, and this bottle kind of looks like not the watermelon. I am very interested in these non-gin color gins. Oh yeah. So here's the shtick with these guys. The marble pink gin and the dry gap gin are take the base Jackson Avenue gin and to do two different things with it. On the pink gin side, they take their base gin and they put it into sherry barrels. Barrels that were used for, Cabernet barrels. Barrels that have been used to store Cabernet wine. Those barrels have a certain grapey characteristic to them. They've been leached with the color of purples and reds, which will naturally, when you put the gin into the barrel, will take the aspects of the oak, take the aspects of the Cabernet, and make something combined together. Now, the dry gap gin, on the other hand, uses a very similar process of aging in barrels, but these are aged in bottles of bourbon, obviously. I say that with such confidence. So on the one hand, we have gin that's been sitting in Cabernet barrels, and on the other hand, we have gin that's been sitting in bourbon barrels, which naturally imparts a different flavor characteristics as well as different colors on both sides. Brad says, I don't typically like barrel-rested gins. Well, I've got some descriptions for you because I like the both of them. Deb says, it looks like a grapefruit.
Good
I agree.
Good night.
Good night, my love. I will see you later on when I eventually am finished with all of this. What time are we at? We're at about the 2-hour and 15-ish minute mark. I'll take
it.
Good night, chat. Good night, Anna, says Brad. Good night, chat, says Anna. You all heard that already. Bye. Love you very much. The show will continue. So these things here were super good. And my original tasting notes for both of them, for the pink gin, was that it was creamy. Had a touch of that Cabernet taste that's a little bit sour. It rests very pleasantly on the palate, kind of like a very nice sweet vermouth. In particular, I'm comparing this to like a little bit of Carpano Antica. I don't know what the base of Carpano Antica is, but I enjoyed it the same way that I, in a similar way that I did to this gin, which is kind of interesting because my sweet vermouth and my gin usually go together in a Negroni. So I wonder how a Negroni would taste with this particular gin here, maybe by swapping something out for that sweet vermouth. I don't know. That's something that I hope to explore at some point in time. The dry gap, on the other hand, has a very, very different smell from the other one, and I will give some notes on the both of those. I'll grab both of my snifters out so we can compare them side by side. It very much tastes very earthy, very, very leafy. None of those cream fruity notes like I got from the pink gin, more of those leafy kind of cinnamony spice notes from the bourbon barrels. I'm gonna open up the both of these. I'm gonna grab one of my snifters over here. I say from Kid Santa saying, consumption! Put that thing in my mouth. What kind of things do I have in my mouth over here? This isn't like a regular cocktail episode, so I actually don't have any food up here, but I got water, so I'll take this as an excuse to give myself a sip. And I'll fill up my water too. Hydration, my friends. Ooh, actually, there's a container of olives staring at me in my little garnish container, but it's not open yet. I will refrain. Wait, actually, I have a good idea. Wait, I have a better idea.
I got you, kid. I got you.
So, we locked ourselves out of our apartment today and had to walk down the street and went to Whole Foods. I found, finally, edible flowers! I've been looking for these for so long, I didn't know that you could get them at Whole Foods. I'ma eat this orange thing. Why the hell would I do that? It says edible again, they said they're edible flowers. They didn't say they tasted good. That is super bitter.
Oh my god. Kid, why would you make me do that?
Incredible. Work it. Reverse lunges. All right. I'm not going down to the floor. Otherwise, I won't be able to do... I guess maybe I can do this. Here, let's open some whiskey as I do some reverse lunges. Also, I'm stepping on bubble wrap from the fish thing that I had before. Edible flowers. My butt. Edible my butt. Don't eat my butt. That's not what I'm trying to imply there. That's inappropriate. Flowers. I'm sure Taylor the Bucket appreciates that. Come along now. Come on, get. I'm not supposed to use my teeth. Can't open this thing. I'm having so much trouble here. I have tools for this. I am man. I have tools. There we go. One of them's off. Oh, I gotta switch legs. Yeah, I have so many bottles back here. Oh my god, here we go. Ha! Party time. It's always a party where we're exercising. I'm getting woozy. It's just because I'm tired and hot, not because of the alcohol. Duh. I'm almost through this. Actually, this is the perfect time for this because evidently I could use the workout and I needed the excuse to open these bottles. So, on the one hand, we have our pink gin. And on the other hand, we have our dry gap gin. One is Cabernet barrels, one is bourbon barrels. Isn't that fun? Those bar lights are warm. Yes. Yes, they are. Fresh bottle opening. Oh yeah, dude. Fresh bottle opening. Oh, hear that squeak. That was not as satisfying. We'll do a little bit of pink gin in one. And a little bit of dry gap in the other. There we go. And we'll tap those back off. I think. Pink. Oh, hello. Get in there. And the other one. Maybe? No, actually, I think it was the other way around. Yeah, it was the other way around. I was wrong. Maybe? There we go. We got it. I do know how to put bottles back together. I promise you that. All right, so we got the two different gins here. One is Cabernet, one is Bourbon. And I loved them both so much while I was there, I had to get them. I also tried a couple of their whiskey flight as well. They had a spicy habanero and honey flavored whiskey called their Dragon Tail. They had a Rye 95, like I-95, like the highway. And they had a couple of different bourbons. And my favorite one was their silver, they had a silver label bourbon, which was like $70. I asked Anna, do I get the $70 bottle of bourbon that I really like? Or do I get the two gins? And she was like, you should get the two gins because it'd be funny to go to the Knox Whiskey Works and not buy a bottle of whiskey. So that's what we went with. So, still got a little piece of flour stuck in my teeth here. Let's do the first of the pink gin. It smells like gin. Very, very junipery. A little bit of citrus notes there. I'm getting a little bit of like lemon citrus there and a slight hint of what almost smells like some sort of green. What that green is exactly, I'm not super sure. I'm just gonna say it's parsley. It's like a leafy type of green. Not like a basil, not like a mint, but like some other type of green. I like that. It's very bright and it's a very springtime smell. And of course it's junipery. The dry gap on the other hand, this green one, a little more mellow, a little more leafy, I'm not getting much citrus notes here. This is very much cabinet spice. This is very much a deeper type of spice note. Not like, let's say, an airy green herb. Something more a little dark. Something a little more close to the ground. Which kind of makes sense for this, for the situations of growth that these two gins had to, you know, chance themselves through. Pink gin. Ooh. Excellent little spice to it. Powerful on those notes of gin, but like there is a certain nice like fruitiness to it. It tastes a little bit like cherry, tastes a little bit like grape. There is a certain characteristic of some cabernets that I've had in the past that I really appreciate because there's something creamy about them. There is something almost sour about them, kind of like the way that sour cream is sour. It's a very similar type of sour that I really like. I like that same flavor. I think it's a common flavor to some coffees. It exists in some wines. It exists in some spirits. And I don't know how else to describe it aside from it's a sourness. I'm sure there's a word that better exists out there, and someday I will learn how to describe that. But for now, for lack of a better term, there is a sourness, not like a lemon sourness, but like a sour, a savory type of sourness. That I think is... Like sour cream is a savory type of sour, I think. That's probably what I'm going for. It has a tang, says Brad. I like that description there. It's tangy. I like the tangy aspect of that. It is tangy. I like that. And it reminds me of Cabernets. I think if I had to go for a red wine, I will usually go for a Cabernet Sauvignon. I like it. I like them very much. I'm a fan of red wines that have that tang to it. I think what I recall... At the part of the trip where I was describing the wedding that I went to, down in the Outer Banks, they were serving cocktails, they were serving wine, they were serving spirits, and it was a lovely and gay old time. They were serving a particular bottle of Cabernet Sauvignon, and they came around to the tables during dinner, and they showed us the bottle, and I took a sip of it, and I was like, this is super good, I love this wine so much, I love that Cabernet Sauvignon. Lo and behold, as the night went on and the dancing began to start, I found that there were other people still walking around with glasses of this Cabernet Sauvignon, and I was on a mission. I had to find this Cabernet Sauvignon. Pretty much all night, in between the other cocktails and dancing and other sort of hors d'oeuvres and stuff, I was asking every bartender, do you have any of that Cabernet Sauvignon? And I was, and out of the, I think the three or four people that I approached, bartender-wise, to try to get a hands on this, I did get it twice. And I finished off at least three or four glasses of it because it was that good. I have been known to finish off entire bottles of wine by myself. It is not a usual thing. It's celebratory in its own special way. But I love Cabernet Sauvignon. So I was very partial towards trying this particular gin and of course picking up a bottle of it. And actually these two here were actually very affordable too. I think both of these were, I think, $35 a piece. And they also do other smaller bottles for some of their other select stuff, like the espresso liqueur that they make as well. Brad says, I mean, that's why you go to the places that have half-price bottles to drink a bottle by yourself. That's about where the purple gin price point is, about the 35. Very cool. I like that. I think I tried to keep things more on the cheaper side to keep it more accessible to people, but I splurged on some things. One of these bottles that I splurged on, I might regret, but... That's the next bottle. That's the one from Kentucky, which I haven't tasted yet. Now for the dry gap gin. I've been talking about this long enough. Let's go for it. This one is it's such an interesting flavor, right? Because to me, gin is very floral. Gin is very herbaceous. To me, whiskey doesn't often come across like that. Whiskey to me is very spice forward. It's very chocolate sometimes. It can be very sweet and caramelly. This combines a little bit of those cocoa notes and those cinnamon spice notes with those floral notes that are coming up from the other gin botanicals there, which is just such an interesting combination. I don't know how else to describe. Like if I can get a little abstract here, this tastes like army camouflage. I'm talking about that combination of the blacks and the browns and the greens and the tans. Like that color scheme, maybe there's a little bit of synesthesia going on or something, but that color scheme describes this perfectly. Like if somebody were to paint this on the wall, paint camouflage on the wall, show me one of those shirts and say, what does that taste like? I'd be like, it tastes like Dry Gap Gin from Knox Whiskey Works. And I stand by that. It tastes really, really good, which is why I got both of the bottles. I am so interested, being a bit of a gin aficionado. I like gin. I'm super curious to see how this plays well in cocktails, let alone be your Negronis or your gin and tonics or otherwise. I'm really curious to see what these gins do at some point. And now that they are part of the Bar with the Next Bottle collection, I hope that they will make their way into more explorational cocktail streams going forward. I think that'll be really fun to explore. But I'll put these bottles away as we move on from Tennessee. We spent a very good time in Tennessee. It was very nice. After we were done with the, in and around the Knoxville Whiskey Works area, we had to make our way up to Kentucky. It was the next part of our journey right before Indianapolis. And we got some Chick-fil-A along the way, which was absolutely the perfect thing to have after the very interesting collection of flavors that did grace my mouth. Afterwards, I drowned it in, a Chick-fil-A Deluxe with Monterey Jack cheese. Did I get a milkshake? I don't remember if I got a milkshake from that. I don't think I actually did. I think there was something else that was happening there. It was good. And we also had nuggets. It was great. Nothing quite like a quick fast food repast on a long and rather exhausting journey. I will say, in total, we drove... Ooh, let's see. One leg of the journey was like 14 hours. One was like 13 hours. We were driving for over. There was at least an entire day of travel. And it was, it was so worth it. Night Night says, Kid Santa, Night Man, enjoy the rest of your stream. Thank you so much, and thank you for popping into the Bar with an X. We'll see you next time. I hope your dreams are well and restful. And as we make our way, considering about the restfulness of our dreams and our streams and our cocktail bar themes, we make our way to Kentucky. Kentucky for Kentucky bourbon, obviously. We made our way into Kentucky, specifically Louisville, Kentucky, which was the final stop before I made our way to Indianapolis. And in Louisville, Kentucky are a number of different places. We've got a number of different distilleries there on the bourbon trail. The one that I managed to get a picture sort of kind of close to was Old Forester, but there's a number of other ones as well. I think on my way, I heard some recommendations of Maker's Mark is down there. Old Forester is down there. There's probably more. Insert literally any other number of Kentucky bourbon here. There's a number of them. I'm not a connoisseur on that front, so I don't have those names readily available to me right now. Anybody could name probably thousands of them. I think actually we saw Old Smoky while we were down there as well. We passed by the exit for that, and there was something else as well. There's so many of them. I do love me some Ofo. Old Forester, I just got that. Ofo. I dig that. What an interesting description. I like it. It's like an acronym, but it's a hyphenated acronym. Old Forester. In any case, so we got to Kentucky. We got to Louisville, Kentucky, and we got some food. We were very, very hungry and very weary from our journey, so we stopped at this place. I had a very nice honey old fashioned made by some dude at a bar. I don't remember the bar's name. It was called Connor's, I think. Or Corner's. Something Corner. It was nice. The food was pretty good. I had a nice turkey club. And was very befuddled from my journey because I was so damn tired and felt like I made a fool of myself, but that's okay. Upon leaving, all the distilleries and stuff were closed. Most of the liquor stores were closed by the time we got there, but I did find one that was open into this little spirits bodega, and I walked in and I had a pleasant conversation with the person who ran the liquor store. I basically pretty much came in, and maybe I set myself up a little weirdly, right? I was like, hey, I'm from out of state. I like to sip cocktails, I like to drink spirits, and I am trying to get a spirit from every single state that I go to, and I'm in Kentucky, and I want your recommendation on what the best Kentucky bourbon is that you sell for a relatively low price point. To which he gave me a whole spiel about some of the really popular ones that he had and pointed at the top shelf for every single one of them, even gave me a view of the bottles that he keeps behind the bar, and he was like, these are probably gonna be the best whiskeys you found. And of the ones he pointed out, every single one of them was over $100. Every single one. And honestly, I think I tried to ask for a little bit of tasting notes on some of them and see like how they were, but it was very general. And to be honest, I felt like I was trying to be pushed to just spend money on product. And I had a fine conversation with them. We talked about whiskey a little bit. We talked about bourbon for a little bit, talked about cigars for a little bit, and it was all well and good. I walked away with the cheapest bottle that he pointed at. Mostly because, instead of being over $100, it's this old Bardstown, Willett's Finest, bottled in bond, $60 bottle of the, quote, greatest Kentucky bourbon. I bought this because it had a horse on it, Kentucky, the Kentucky Derby, all that kind of stuff, and because the back of the bottle very boldly claimed that this was the greatest Kentucky bourbon. And I remember when I tried to Google this, I couldn't really find this anywhere. It's on some website for this company called Willett's Finest Quality, and it just feels so general. And it feels like, I feel like the back of the bottle, the label in this bottle is not, I don't know if it's accurate. So this was another risk that I took. The Ghost Coast was one of the risks that I took. I bought that bottle without tasting it. This was another one. I don't know. I have no idea whether this is going to be as good as it is. It's a snap-off bottle top, so let's try that. There we go. Freshly open. I have not tasted this yet. Let's see how the greatest Kentucky bourbon, notably a bottled and bond, which is means it is 50%, 100 proof. We'll see how that goes. I'm hoping that it's okay. And if it's not, whatever. We'll find uses for this bottle. The Bar with an X is always happy to provide. So, I have done literally no research on this. I know nothing about Olds Bardstown. I did a little cursory research to try to Google it, and I got mixed reviews, I guess. I'm excited to watch this go down. I'm very excited to see whether or not this $60 bottle of bourbon, the greatest Kentucky bourbon, actually stands up to its name. So, let's see. On the nose, it smells like bourbon whiskey. I'm getting a nice sweet note there, to be honest. Like, honestly, for a bottled and bond, this isn't, like, singeing my nose like some of the other whiskeys happen to do. Except when I stick my nose right into it, then it started to get the burn. On the upfront, like, it's almost a little grassy. It's not that bad. Almost kind of like hay. And hay is for horses, and I don't think that's just by association. Although I seem to have a track record for coming up with comparisons that are related to what I see in the bottle. And if that seems to allude to me judging books by their cover or spirits by their bottle, I stand by it. Oh, it's actually not that bad. It's actually kind of nice. I don't know what the mash bill is on this, but I would bet that there's a good bit of rye in there. It's got a nice spice to it. It's actually kind of sweet. It's kind of sweet on the forefront. It's like, just kind of feels plain. It tastes a little plain. I can get notes of corn in there. I can get notes of rye in there. Actually, I'm going to try to look up the mash bill for this guy. Old Bardstown mash bill. Old Bardstown mash bill. Let's see, what do we got there? Old Bardstown Kentucky Date Bourbon. 72% corn, 13% rye, 15% malted barley. Works well as a solid anytime sipper. Soft light feel. A workhorse of a whiskey. I'm not the only person who made the horse comparison. I'm not, and I will not be the last. It does very much taste like corn. It's got a little bit of rye to it. It's just kind of base. I don't know. I feel almost a little pretentious for saying this, but this doesn't really taste like anything special. It just tastes like whiskey. And that's not bad at all. Rich says, you're like, I'm getting notes of glass. This smells like bottle. It does smell like bottle. It smells like the horse in the bottle. Those hay, you know, those hay is for horses stuff. I mean, seriously though. I mean, maybe, actually, I'm gonna challenge myself here. Maybe I've just been using the snifter a little bit more. I'm gonna take a fresh cordial glass. I'm gonna give it another taste. I think I actually kind of like this. There's nothing special happening here, to be honest. It tastes like corn. It tastes like rye. That's comfortable. Getting small notes of like a little bit of vanilla there. Actually, this is probably the most vanilla forward one in terms of just how the simplicity of it, in the sense that oak flavors tend to add a little bit of those vanilla cinnamony notes to them, those kind of cabinet spices. And like, I get that. I get that here. And it's even kind of sweet. I like that. Again, it's not... And actually, let me take a step back for a moment. It's not like there's nothing special. It's comfortable. It's a very comfortable whiskey. This feels to me like a very easy sipping whiskey. It's not something that you need to think about very much. It's something you could just grab, pour, and enjoy. Now, I'm curious to see how this tastes with a little bit of water dropped into it to see what other kind of characteristics pop up. Maybe there's more to the story than we're giving credit for. I did not get any water in there. There we go, just a little bit. Give it a little bit of a swirl and we'll see if we have any sort of update. I don't know. getting a little more, it's a little less prominent on the nose now. Got like a hint of caramel, he says questionably. Yeah, that's just kind of, that's kind of like a sweet paint varnish a little bit. It opened up, it made it a little, it actually, I feel like the water actually didn't help super much. It got a little more caramelly, but I'm starting to realize that there's a bit of a very chemical backbone to it that's just kind of hand sanitizer-y, kind of like some vodkas are. Not necessarily out of place per se, but noticeable. Noticeable indeed. That's what Kentucky has to offer. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't want to be the person to stand here and say, that's Kentucky for you. Sorry. See you next time. There is so much prevalency in that Kentucky bourbon trail and the whiskey stuff in Tennessee and whatnot that, like, we could do entire explorations of. And one day, if I have the honor of doing so, I would love to do that. I actually, when I was down there visiting with Anna, I was like, it would be super duper cool to just get a gang together, go down the bourbon trail, do a bit of exploration, and see what it's all about, to really get the idea of the people who have been there before, and to kind of get an idea of like the history and the context behind all of this stuff. This may be, according to the bottle, the greatest Kentucky bourbon. Not necessarily of all time, but there's more than just that. There's more to just Kentucky than the bourbon. There's more to the bourbon than just the Kentucky. And that's something I'd love to explore if I ever have the pleasure to do so sometime in my life. One day, but not today, because there is work to be done and a bar to be run. Specifically the bar with an X, the bar that you see right here. It's got an X on it somewhere, I promise you that. I'm Karen with the X, if you didn't already catch that. We'll put that down there, and we'll move on to, let's see, the next part of our journey, which happens to be the final destination of our second leg of our trip, which was Indianapolis, Indiana. Now, without going too far into it, because I am noticing that we're running up on the 3-hour mark here, I could talk at length about how awesome Gen Con was. We met new friends, hung out with old friends, we got played new board games, we bought some stuff and whatnot, and it was super duper exciting. It was really, really cool to have the family vacation line up with Gen Con this week year, which we got a 4-day pass for that we got totally for free because we volunteered for this organization called Board Crunch, who runs games of Dice Throne and King of Tokyo and Keyforge and a lot of it. That's an excellent group of individuals. And if you go to Gen Con every year, I hope to see you next year because we will most definitely be returning in the year 2024 for Gen Con. And I don't want to get too far into that because I could talk at length about it. Some of the highlights, though, of that is some things that we picked up along our journey. Along the way, we stopped at a thrift store before actually getting to Indianapolis, where I picked up some wormwood and I picked up some elderberries. These are some botanicals that I plan on infusing at some point in the future, maybe to theme it around a Bar with an X special or special videos and stuff that I'd love to put out there. And in addition, while we were actually there at in the convention center, I picked up a couple of different teas and stuff, specifically from this stand called Dryad Tea. They had two that were very smoky, some Lapsang Souchong bases, and one that was, I think, an Earl Grey modification. I like tea. That's not necessarily what we do here at the Bar with an X, but in general, I enjoy tea, and as such, we'll eventually, I'm sure I'll talk about it at some point. There's a bunch of other stuff that I picked up at the table over there as well, but I'm running out of time. In particular, I got a bunch of these Catan coasters, which are great. They've got Catan on the front. They got the blue on the back, just like the board piece does, and they're hexagons, which I love. And there's a game that Anna and I really love called The Red Dragon Inn, when we got these coasters that have the decals of the coins that you use in the game, which will be making appearances here at the Bar with an X. In addition, that game that you caught us playing 2 weeks ago, we actually met the creators of the game and got the box signed, which this is really cool, actually. I will show this real quick. I'll switch the cocktail angle over here. They signed the box, and they signed it to our little Bar with an X there. There we go. I thought was really, really kind of them. They did it all personal like this, which I thought was super duper cool, which I absolutely love. I love to see that type of personality and stuff showcased at these conventions, where
You get to see the human side of things, and I felt super duper honored by that.
We also had some of the we also got the expansion for the game as well, which we didn't cover when we tried it, when we played it 2 weeks ago. And one of the people who actually consulted for the game signed one of our cards on the inside. They go by Dr. Inkwell, aka Drinkwell, and they do their own content on the interwebs as well, which hopefully I'll be sharing a little bit of, because I think it's pretty cool, and the whole history behind how they make the game and stuff is very, very, very cool. Rich says, if you ever make your way through Chattanooga, Tennessee, I can recommend their single barrel. Had it last time I was there. It was very, very nice. They also do some experimental batches that look interesting, but have not been able to partake yet. That note on Chattanooga. I will take note of that very much so. I don't know where that is on my map over here, but I'm just going to point there and say Chattanooga. Chattanooga. Chattanooga, let's say small batch. I'll put that there. Small batches. That's like, I watched the whole, video series of like different types of like whiskey stuff in preparation for this journey. And the idea that like people go crazy over particular batches of whiskey because they search out batch numbers and whatnot was something that I think is absolutely wild. Chattanooga whiskey. I did track that down. Appreciate that recommendation. But it's so interesting that people will go after like their particular batches that they love so much because the flavors will change over time. That's, I think, a really incredible thing to me. But alas, I digress, and I am running out of breath, to be honest. So we'll move on to the point of where we found ourselves with Indiana. Now, we stayed over with a couple of friends in Indiana, and one of the things that I asked was naturally, as a denizen of the area, what would you recommend me grab as a spirit of the area? And he specifically recommended this Hotel Tango brand of spirits. They do cordials, they do whiskeys, they do a vodka, and I believe they also do a gin as well. We stopped at a liquor store on our way out after Gen Con, and I stopped in a local liquor store and asked, hey, do you have anything that's local? I'm looking for something called Hotel Tango. And they were like, oh my gosh. And they gave me the whole rundown of all the different bottles they had. And I wound up settling on this little orange cello bottle, which Rich Nose pointed out. It's cool because when I asked my friend what I should grab, he was like, Hotel Tango. I was like, what does the bottle look like? And he was like, they do a lot of things with the military and stuff. So it looks like an MRE. And I was like, cool. And I will admit, that's exactly what those little like ration containers look like. So I think that's pretty cool. I like the branding that they have around it. It's also very easy to read. But as I was going through the various different options that they had, the orange cello caught my eye. There was an orange cello next to a lemon cello. And I was like, well, I've never tried orange cello before. I've got to give this a try. So that's the bottle that we went with. It's very, very cool indeed. It's a very nice bottle. I agree with that. I'll put this in my little container over here. And we'll give that a taste. I did try this with a couple of friends that we met up with on the way back from Gen Con, which we'll expand upon in just a little bit. Let's do a little bit of that, of our orange cello, which we won't spend too much time on because from what I can recall, it's a very honest and very open bottle. Right on the nose as I'm smelling my fingers as I take it off, it's like there's this air freshener that you can get. Like this orange air freshener, and it smells kind of like that. I think that it might be Glade air freshener. It kind of smells like an orange candle. It's very, very nice. It's a particular type of orange. Actually, Anna has this orange perfume that kind of smells like this. Maybe it's like a Satsuma orange type thing, but it is very, very nice. It's almost got, it's like an orange cream to it. It's very orange cream, I would say. And it tastes very similar to that. In the same way that limoncello often tastes a little zesty, like the zest and oils of the lemon, this feels like it's the zest of an orange. Much like that feeling you get when you take the orange and you bite right into it. Not that anybody else is crazy enough to do that. I do that often and did do that this morning. This is kind of that flavor. It's very much orange oil as opposed to the orange juice, but it's very, very nice. It almost reminds me of an oleosacrum that I made a while ago utilizing orange peels. This kind of occupies the same space. It's got a nice sweetness to it. It's very orange forward and it's just generally delicious. This is a nice, I feel like this would be a nice stand-in for limoncello and anything if you wanted to change up the type of citrus that you were using. And I feel like this would just work as a really, really nice like orange liqueur, whether you try to sub it out for a triple sec or a curacao or like, I think it's tasty. And I think also too that it would probably go really well. I feel like this would go really well with gin. I just like that particular type of sweet citrus with the type of gins that I'm used to, or even a modification to, I don't know, any number of cocktails out there. It's nice, it's orangey, it's orange cello. Hotel Tango, from Indianapolis, Indiana. And with that, I put this bottle behind, and that is pretty much the end. That is more or less the end of the second leg of our trip. And there was really only one trip remaining, and this was arguably the least exciting part of the trip, although there were some nice fun things along the way as well, including a little gift shop that we stopped at, where it was a little thrift shop that we stopped at in the Appalachian Mountains, where I picked up a mortar and pestle that's made out of glass. So maybe at some point in the future we'll be able to have some like live demonstrations of actually making our own infusions, making our own spirits, and actually crushing up all the botanicals and stuff, which I wasn't expecting to do. But when a glass mortar and pestle falls into your lap for $50, a little steep, you take that and you put it in the dishwasher first. You actually clean that thing off. But we also naturally had to pass through Ohio and Pennsylvania, so we stopped at something along the way as well. In particular, when we stopped in Ohio, we tried to find a liquor store. We tried to find a distillery. We did find this place called High Bank Distillery, which said that they were open. But nobody picked up the phone, nobody opened the door, and there was nobody there, so we didn't actually have a chance to go inside. I missed them, I pinged them on social media to ask when they would be open, and got completely ghosted, but that's fine. I'm not mad at all. We went into the town of Columbus, Ohio, and tried to find a liquor store. We went to one store that claimed it was open, and it was totally closed. So we moved on to another store, went to the local Kroger, which claimed that it had a liquor store, and it did. But I walked inside and I couldn't find it. I walked all the way around to the wine and beer section and I found an associate and asked, "Hey, do you guys sell liquor?" And she said, "Yes." And I said, "Great, can you buy it on Sundays?" Because it was a Sunday. She said, "Yes, but you're in the wrong section." So she escorts me around the store all the way to the back to the dairy section where there is a door in the middle of the store that enters into the entire liquor collection. There was quite literally a liquor store embedded in the heart of this Kroger in the middle of Columbus, Ohio, which was such a vibe. I was so confused, but I dig it. So I walked inside, nodded to the police officer, nodded to the clerk at the front. I was like, "Hey, local boss." And a gentleman no older than probably 21 was like, "Yeah, it's over in that corner over there." And I'll be honest, I had a little bit of a hard time trying to find the Ohio stuff. So I saw this bottle that said Cleveland. So I went with a bottle that said Cleveland, like Cleveland, Ohio. So that's the bottle that I went with. Another kind of out there trying to, a bit of another one of those kind of spirit takers risk, I guess, because I don't know what the bottle tastes like, but it was the cheapest local thing that I could find. So I went with it, and that's what we are going to taste. I have absolutely no idea what this is supposed to taste like. And they seal it so frustratingly that I have to get out my knife so I can actually open this thing up because it's all foiled and stuff. Oh, actually, it's got a tab on it. Leave it to me to try to over-engineer something. All right, here we go. I like the orange color on it. For some reason, when I think of Ohio, I think of the color orange, too. And I don't exactly know why. Fresh bottle. Cleveland, Ohio. We didn't actually go through Cleveland, Ohio. This is just where the bottle was distilled in. We'll try a little bit of that. A little bit of Cleveland on my mind, or something like that. There's a piece of me that really wants to get this little orange foil off, but it just ain't happening. There we go. So the Cleveland, Ohio bottle says right on the back, Cleveland whiskey. The experts say that it all takes time, that we need to let the angels take their share. And our personal favorite, it's always been done that way. We've been told that using our pressure aging technology is sacrilege, that we're industry heretics, and that it's simply impossible to make good whiskey unless you do it the same way as everybody else. We always colored outside the lines, threw away the rule books, and stayed up well past our bedtimes. We were curious, we were persistent, and we never liked it when people told us, "No, that's not the way that it's done." Even creating the 87 was a step outside the box. Is this the 87? This is the 87. It was a step outside the box. Was a step using pressure and oxygen. We pushed the taste to just the right place. No excuses. Drink what you like. Age is irrelevant. Taste is all that matters. I vibe with that. I did not read the back of this bottle when I purchased this, and I'm very, very impressed by the narrative that they spun here. I'm very much looking forward to trying this Cleveland whiskey. Look at that! Oh, this is gonna be great. Woo! Look at that, a swirl. It smells clean. It smells very clean. Not getting any particular flavor notes here. A little grainy. And you know what? All right, this is gonna sound weird. This smells a little bit like farts. Just a little bit. I stick my nose in there and I'm like, this smells okay, but And I don't think it's me, to be honest. Let's give it a taste. I wonder how it tastes. If this is supposed to be outside the box, I see what they're going for. Ooh, it's a little, Interesting. It does not taste like farts. I will give it that. Definitely not. There is something odd about this, though. I wouldn't say it reminds me of corn. Doesn't remind me of rye. There's a little bit of rye in there. I can taste something that feels a bit spicy there. Not rice. Doesn't taste like barley. It tastes a little malty, but I don't really know what it is. I haven't even, like, there's almost a piece of me here that almost feels like this is just the slightest bit citrusy. It is interesting. And it's dry. It's a drying whiskey as well. I look forward to seeing how it effect the water has on this, because I feel like there's more secrets to this whiskey than what I'm currently getting right here. Let's see. This remains to be seen for now. Okay. Getting a little something different here. Not quite farty anymore. I think it's kind of transformed into something that's a little more down to earth. Nah, it's still a little farty. Methane-y. Nah, I can get that now. It's not going away. It's so wild. I don't really know what that is. It's almost barn-y. I'm getting flashbacks to like the hay comparisons that I was making for that Kentucky bourbon and the way that it smelled, but it's a little more off-putting, but not in a bad way. There's something that I would almost call even a little funky about this, like the way that a banana peel is dry. It does not taste like banana, but there is something about it. It's ripe. It tastes ripe, but for something that usually doesn't have notes of fruit or otherwise, whiskey being that in general, I find it very interesting to describe how ripe this tastes, which is interesting. I've never had that on a whiskey before. Well, if anybody else has any idea what the heck I'm experiencing here, maybe, all right, Alexa, let's take a look at the mash bill. I am very curious to see whether that's something that can be pieced out because of the ingredients. Cleveland, the 85. What is it, the 85? The 87. Whiskey review, Cleveland whiskey, the 87. Mash bill is 75% corn, 20% rye, 4% malted barley. There is a one-star review for this whiskey. Interesting. What's wrong with it, Craig? Neat, its spirit and its color. First aroma is strong. Woody notes like plywood, fig, cinnamon, chewing gum. I don't really get that. I can understand the fig, though, in the sense that it smells a little ripe. I can get that. The review said overall rating 1 out of 5. Interesting. They tried to make a whiskey aging process jump to light speed. Unfortunately, their R2-D2 unit is not quite ready. Interesting. Well, this is apparently somebody judging from the perspective of comparing it to other aged whiskeys. I mean, you can try, I guess. I wonder what... It finished with an oxygen-enriched and accelerated process. It doesn't say exactly how many... Oh, it's 87 because it's 87 proof. Interesting. Anyway, that's as much time that I'm going to spend on the Cleveland Bourbon Whiskey. I feel like that's something that needs to be explored at some point. And maybe we will. I'm sure it will pop up. It's a part of the Bar with an X Bottle collection now, so one day. One day soon. But we move on. We weren't in Ohio for very long. We were only in Ohio as so far as to stop in the liquor store and stop for a little bit of food. It was nice. And then we moved on with our lives as we paced through the remainder of Pennsylvania. Now, Pennsylvania was relatively uneventful, I would say, on the spirits side of things. Now, I will say we did take a little stop around Lancaster area, around Pittsburgh area, on our way to Harrisburg, where we took a little bit of stop for the day and rested our heads for a little while. We visited some friends. It was nice because these are some friends that I hold very near and dear to my heart, and I had all of these bottles of liquor with me, and I had the esteemed pleasure of doing a little bit of an impromptu live Bar with an X session for these friends of ours, and we got to taste some of these bottles ahead of time, which was really, really fun to do. In addition, these friends of ours, as it tends to be the case when Cameron with an X winds up visiting, is they gave us a couple of goodies. I need to find where those goodies are because they are in a bag, and I didn't bring them close to here. I think they're on the floor over here. Yes. Yes, they are. Let me bring those up to the top real quick. There we go. So they actually, a while ago, they popped onto a stream where we were chatting, and they were at a Renaissance fair type thing or something like that, and they actually found these little containers that are wax sealed, and they're pre-made just add spirit cocktail stuff, which I thought was really, really cool. They picked up a couple of bottles for us. Now, they're wax sealed, and they're very potent, and they have to be used within a certain amount of time, so I'm not comfortable opening these up here, but they are from Mystic Mixers Potion Bar. One is the Elixir, which is this orange one you see over here, and it is suggested to be combined with, it's got these cute little like, these burned labels on them. It's beautiful. It's created with lapsang tea, agave, ginger, and lemon, infused apple cider vinegar and sugar, filtered water, citric and malic acid, and a little bit of salt. From Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And then the other one is our Firekeeper, which was made utilizing coffee, water, brown sugar, orange extract, sugar, cinnamon, clove, anise, citric acid, and malic acid. Orange, coffee, cacao, and spices. Shake well. Both of these are very, very, they've got the sediment at the bottom. You just need to mix them with spirit, evidently. And at some point, I look forward to trying the both of these at some point. I don't know if that's something that we'll cover on a Bar with an X stream. I feel like we will. Actually, no, I will say that we definitely will. I imagine the next time we do either Renaissance, Mystic Libations, or something related to fantasy, these bottles will probably make an appearance. But in the meantime, they will not be opened until then. I want to appreciate the lovely people that I have in my life yet again for the contributions they make so that we can all explore this together and be able to do all this in the fashion that we're doing it. I greatly appreciate it. But so we spent a little bit of time there, and in addition, we didn't actually get to the distillery in Lancaster. This is something that I picked up actually a while ago, but in terms of the taste of Pennsylvania, I wanted to pick up this bottle that's been sitting in my closet for a while that I might have brought onto the stream at some point, but I might not have brought onto the stream. And this is a Lancaster Distillery's Forager Special Brandy. This is something that we actually picked up with the same set of friends at a food festival type thing, a food and drink festival called Taste Philadelphia that we went to, and they had a number of spirits there. I got to meet a couple of the people who actually run the distilleries and some of the bottle producers and stuff, and so we picked up this bottle, which was just super duper interesting. Interestingly enough, when I was still working for a company called Amatech, an aerospace defense company, I worked with a guy that we called, I'm trying to remember his name. I know what his actual name is, but we called him something else, and for some, Pete, I think we called him Pete, to be honest. I don't think it was his actual name, though. But while we were hanging there, he was a wonderful guy. He sat in the cubicle with me and my fellow co-op, me being a software student in college at the time. He was just a really, really kind individual, always smiling, always jovial, always with a quick joke at hand. I appreciated him greatly. And one day, he gave me and some of my other fellow co-op these seeds for a pawpaw plant. And he told us a little bit of history of the pawpaw, and that is the only, I think, only native indigenous fruit to Pennsylvania, and I believe the aboriginals of the area were very familiar with it. These are words that I think I might be remembering from a couple of years ago. I'm probably misquoting them. And for all, I think for what it's worth, I'm not sure if the pawpaw actually comes from Pennsylvania, but it reminds me of some of those really good times that we had while I was still working there. Although it really wasn't the best job that I had. It was mostly putting Excel numbers into sheets and a little bit of confusion. But I did get to work on some really, really cool like helicopter plane stuff, so that was pretty awesome. But so it reminds me of that. The pawpaw seeds I had, I put in a freezer and they wound up growing moldy and I had to toss them. But for what it's worth, it made an impact on my life. And so when I saw this bottle here, a brandy that uses just the slightest bit of pawpaw flavor, I was like, I gotta try this. And it's a 375 milliliter bottle, so it's not a full bottle of this stuff. And it does have this interesting bit of sediment in it. And I've actually taken a little bit down of this before. I've subbed it out for brandy before. I've sipped it on its own before, and it's just interesting. So I wanna give a little bit of tasting notes here for you all, because it's very interesting and definitely worth your time. Also, because there really wasn't any brandies that I found along the way. It didn't seem like tequila was really difficult to get your hands on. Burnt Church Distillery notably does produce an agave spirit that they can't call tequila, and they have a Blanco and Reposado version of it, but they were totally out of it, and the bottle shop was closed anyway. I didn't get to taste it. I was kind of disappointed. Hilton Head Distillery had their rums, but they weren't open either, and I couldn't get access to their bottles, so I wasn't able to bring rum back either. And to be honest, brandy never showed up at all. I don't think any place that I went to was advertising brandy as a spirit that you could taste, which I honestly didn't think about it until now, which I think is actually kind of interesting. So this is the opportunity that we have to go through this. And I'm sure, I don't know if Lancaster Distillery, they do a couple of different things. I don't know if they do more brandies, but this is a good one. I'll pour a little bit more of that, because that's probably what I will be enjoying. This is the last spirit that I have for tasting this evening as we kind of wrap things up over here. This is something that I'll sip on while we do a little bit of editing and stuff afterwards. It'll be fun. So this is a brandy, meaning it was distilled from fruits and whatnot. Exactly what those fruits are at the base, I'm not exactly sure. They add some pawpaw flavor to it, but they say that this spirit was distilled from apples. And the pawpaw is actually, by the way, I'll pull over the cocktail angle just for a little bit to give you a view of the bottle over here, because a pawpaw is kind of a pear-like fruit. It looks like those little guys. They look like little, like, kind of fist-sized pears there. And they're pretty good. They're kind of pear-like, obviously. They're kind of apple-like. I never actually tasted a pawpaw. Only pawpaw essence as it pertains to this brandy here, which, right off the nose, this kind of smells very similar to the cachaça that I have, the blonde cachaça. It's got this ripe pear and a ripe banana note to it, except instead of it being more banana-y, it's more that it's a very ripe fruit. It smells like a very ripe fruit that might have been sitting on the counter for a little bit too long, which I think is actually really, really approachable. I kind of like those funky flavors and funky smells that I'm still trying to get used to, and love the way that they play in cocktails, especially things like tiki drinks or other things that's combined with citrus. For example, a caipirinha with your cachaça, which I think goes really well with the LeBlanc cachaça that I have. This will probably make a pretty good substitute there too, at least based off the smell. The taste is also a little bit of a different story. And in a similar way, it reminds me very much of cachaça, but except them being very banana forward, very sweet, very sugarcane, this is a little bit more, it's sweet in a different type of way. I would argue to say, based off of my very, very limited knowledge of the acids that exist in certain types of fruits, I would say that this is more or less the same flavor profile, but shifted using based off of the different types of acids that exist in, let's say, a pawpaw or a pear versus a banana. It's funky, it's ripe, it's fruity, and it's just so unique compared to other things. It really, like, it doesn't even really taste like the brandies that I'm used to or cognacs that I'm used to. It does a little bit in the sense that I do get those more appley notes, those more stone fruity notes, but this is just something else entirely. And personally, I love pears. If I had to pick a favorite fruit relating to an apple, I don't really like apples, but I do really, really like pears. Pears are really, really cool, including those Asian pears. Oh my God, they're awesome. And I'm sure there's a bunch of different types of Asian pears, and there's probably a particular one that I'm referring to, but we get some delivered for work every single year, and they're so good. And this tastes like candy. It's so damn good. This is not the same as an Asian pear. It's not even the same as a regular pear, but it is similar in that vein. But it's very, very good. And it also kind of smells like apple cider vinegar and just very slightly of mac and cheese, but I think that might just be because of the whole everything that's gone into the sniffer glass so far. It definitely needs a little bit of a clean, I'm guessing. But now that I'm smelling it, that does kind of smell like mac and cheese. Interesting. So that's very interesting things that we find on our spirits journey here. And that's the last bottle that I have for you. We've gone through absolutely every single one, and I think I'll do a little bit of a roundup over here, just kind of giving a little bit of a summary of where the heck we were, where the heck we're going, and so on and so forth. I'll put all of my bottles up on here for the world to see as we do, as we kind of close things off over here. Overall, I will say in summary, that this journey was really, really, really fun. This was probably the most driving that I have done in a while. It was the most distinct places that I've been to within a particular period of time. And it was so cool. Anna did an amazing job picking out all of the distilleries. She was in charge of all of the of figuring out all the lodgings that weren't predetermined. She was in charge of finding all of its distilleries to go to. And honestly, most of this stuff would not have happened if not for her determination and her passion for finding out the details of the logistics. So I love that woman so very much. I thank her so very much from the bottom of my heart, because I feel like I benefited very greatly from this. And so I will take that in stride and just take my thankfulness and hopefully pass it on to the next person. As a part of this sort of spirits road trip that we went on, it wasn't specifically about the spirits, but we did find spirits along the way. Previously, I've gone to states including Vermont, Virginia, New Jersey, and otherwise to pick up spirits that are either near and dear to my hometown or close to my family and friends. In particular, the bottle that I would recommend from New Jersey, based off of my experience, is the Skunktown Vodka, a very smooth vodka that tastes very, very good, and in my opinion, has a cool characteristic that I think is different than Tito's. In particular, too, while we were up in Vermont, we pick up this bottle of Vermont whiskey that was infused with Vermont maple syrup, which does have a sort of maple characteristic to it, but it's very, very corny. It's nice, and those, yeah, that's my thoughts on it. I don't need to breathe and drink water. Let's see. another trip that we took, so previous to the one that we took there, was we took a little trip down to OBX, the Outer Banks, and passed through this place called Cape Charles Distillery, which is in Virginia, where they sell a woo-woo vodka, which we happen to pick up a bottle of. Anna really, really likes it. She likes her vodka, so we picked up a bottle from her. It's distilled 3 times more than Tito's, 9 times instead of 6, and it's good. It's very good. We'd probably mix well with pretty much anything. While we were down in the Outer Banks, I picked up a bottle from a liquor store down there because I was having a trouble finding local spirits, and picked up this salted caramel spirit. I don't know if it's whiskey, I don't know if it's vodka, but it tastes like salted caramel, and I will also say goes really well in coffee based off of my prior experience thus far. The actual start of the journey started in Philadelphia and found our way going down through Delaware, where we did not stop at, through Maryland, which we did stop at, and picked up a bottle of well nicely priced Sagamore rye, the $30 price tag just about as compared to the $40-$50 plus price tag for the bottle of Sagamore that I can find at my local liquor store. It felt better like a gateway, and I really did appreciate it. There are some notes of, I guess, cinnamon, clove, and honey that I really appreciate from the Sagamore, and of course, it's a rye that has a nice spice to it, like other ryes do. As we made our way down through Maryland, we passed through Virginia yet again. Technically, the only bottle from Virginia that I happen to have was that one that we picked up in the Cape Charles, so it technically was not a part of our journey, but we did stay the night in Richmond, Virginia, woke up to have coffee at a place called Roastology, which was a very nice vibe, and then met up with our friends in Durham, North Carolina, for a bottle that was given to us, this Conniption Purple Gin, this Conniption Kinship Gin, which is very, very nice. It's very botanical. It's got a nice earthiness to it. It reminds me a lot of the peeled cucumber, and it's got butterfly pea flower in it. So naturally, what will happen is if you mix it with any sort of citrus, it will change color, which is cool. It's the first pre-bottled purple gin, or the pre-bottled butterfly pea flower gin, that it's made its way to the Bar with an X, and I want to thank More Than Awesome for that, because without this particular contribution, it would not be here to taste today.
As we moved our way through North Carolina, we found ourselves in South Carolina, where we tasted a number of different spirits that didn't actually make it back to the bar with an X, including spirits from Hilton Head Distillery, speaking of which, a lot of their rum selection, and Burnt Church Distillery. They had a number of different options, but we weren't able to pick up a bottle from any of them. If I had to pick one from Burnt Church Distillery, I would have gone with their Cucumber and Pepper Vodka, I think it was. And if I had to pick from Hilton Head Distillery, it would have been their Grilled Pineapple Rum, because that shit was a super, super duper good. While we were hanging out down south on that first leg of our journey, we did happen to go to Savannah, Georgia as well, where I picked up my Savannah, Georgia whiskey of choice this year, which happened to come from Ghost Coast, a distillery that is no longer with us. I found one of their older bottles of product, and it is just such a complex whiskey. It was a bit of a risk. I got a really good recommendation from the people who work at River Street Liqueur, and I'm very happy that they gave me the explanation that they did, because it led me to buying that bottle, which is probably going to be might be my de facto good night sipping whiskey going forward. It's delicious, it's complex, it's got a lot of playroom to go around with, and it's really, really good. I would highly recommend that. After we were done on the first part of our journey, we made our way from Hilton Head Island, South Carolina, all the way up to Indianapolis, passing through a number of different states. We passed through North Carolina one more time to stop at a place called Two Trees Distillery, where they gave us a number of different spirits to taste, including some from a series of folklore for the type of creatures that exist up in the Appalachian Mountains. They utilize a fast aging process, a rapid maturation process, using shredded up roasted wood chips, and I forgot to mention that they actually sell those bottles of roasted wood chips that you can take back to smoke your meats or smoke your cocktails. I did not buy a bag of that, but maybe one day I will, because I've been thinking about it a little bit more since we left. And I really like this bottle of candy apple whiskey spirit. She really likes it a lot. It tastes like a candy apple, kind of smells like a Werther's Original caramel candy, and I think it would go really, really well in, let's say, apple cider or coffee or otherwise. It's a nice sweet spirit that I look forward to playing around with, especially in cocktails, because it's just a spirit that we don't have here. And I'll mention the same thing for the salted caramel as well. Those are two different spirit flavors that we don't actually have here yet, and now we do, and so I'm sure it'll make its way into cocktails going later forward. Maybe we get a little bit more experimentational in the future, which I feel really confident on. As we made our way past through North Carolina through the Appalachian Mountains on the southern front, we found ourselves in Tennessee. Tennessee whiskey is a thing, so we naturally stopped by the Tennessee Whiskey Works, where, obviously, we didn't pick up whiskey at all. We actually picked up two different gins. We have the Bar with an X's first pink gin, which is made by taking their standard gin and aging it in Cabernet barrels for a while, giving it a nice creamy and sweet fruity characteristic. And then on the other hand, we have this dry gap gin, which is a similar concept to aging in a barrel, except instead of a Cabernet barrel, it was done in a bourbon barrel. Both of them, very nice. This one kind of sweet and creamy, this one kind of down to earth and oddly cinnamony. It's weird because they are both gins, so especially for the dry gap, that is just a very interesting flavor combo of the kind of floral, junipery notes of the gin combined with the cinnamon and almost chocolatey notes from the bourbon barrel that it sat in. Just not a combo that I'm very used to. It's just really, really weird, and I like that so much. And the next part of our journey, after we were done with Tennessee and obviously not getting any whiskey over there, we passed our way through Bourbon Country in Kentucky. And we were stopped in Louisville for a little bit, passed by the Old Forester Distillery, passed by the Maker's Mark Distillery, got a view of a sign on the road advertising at least four or five different times the Old Smoky Distillery, but none of those places were open. So we stopped for a bite. I stopped in a local liquor store, probably almost got conned into buying really, really expensive whiskey, but did buy a bottle of Old Bardstown, which on the back of it says, "The Greatest Kentucky Bourbon." And you know what? It's an easy whiskey. It tastes pretty good. I wouldn't say that there's too much going on for it, but it's simple, it's easy to drink, and I think it would probably go well in cocktails as well, despite the fact that it's got the, you know, $60? Yeah, $60 price tag. Maybe for the more bougier Boulevardiers or Manhattans and Old Fashions and otherwise. I'd love to try that in an Old Fashioned, actually. That would be probably a good way to try that out. But after we were done passing through Kentucky, we went to our second final destination, which was Indianapolis, Indiana, where Anna and I attended Gen Con for 4 days straight, enjoying the company of our friends that we met a couple years ago, as well as some new friends, played a shit ton of board games, grabbed a couple of things along the way, and on our way out, we grabbed a bottle of Hotel Tango Orange Cello based off of a recommendation from our hosts while we were staying in Indianapolis. They have a bunch of different types of spirits, including whiskeys, I believe a gin and a vodka, but as I was being walked through the different options at the liquor store right outside of Indianapolis, I saw this Orange Cello, and I was like,
I've never had orange cello before. So this is the BarWithAnX's first bottle. It tastes like orange. Like zesty orange. It's very, very tasty. I can imagine that being a nice substitute for triple sec or a dry curacao, or even used in place of a limoncello in some other recipes, such as a flip or otherwise. And then the last state that we went through that wasn't our home state was passing through Ohio. We went to High Bank Distillery and they were closed. We went to a liquor store and it was closed. We went to a Kroger and there was a liquor store in the heart of the Kroger where I was able to find this bottle of Cleveland whiskey, which was interesting. Evidently, they use another sort of rapid maturing process that people don't seem to review very well. For some reason, when I smelled the whiskey, I thought it kind of smelled like farts for a little bit. Didn't taste like farts. It's probably good in some way, shape, or form. Excuse me. But that's something that I think should be explored a little bit more going forward. I will admit, I had a little bit of trouble finding a bottle out in Ohio. So I grabbed the bottle that said Cleveland, because Cleveland is in Ohio. We actually picked it up at Columbus, Ohio, not Cleveland. I did not get a chance to visit the distillery, but maybe one day. Or maybe the next time that I pass by a High Bank Distillery, they'll actually be open according to the posted hours that they have on their website and on their door. Alas. But then what we did is we passed back through Pennsylvania where we took another brief moment to catch up with some friends of ours, do a little bit of a live tasting with the spirits we collected so far. And as we find our way home, I'm reflecting upon Lancaster Distillery, which we didn't actually get to go visit, but we did find a bottle from them at a convention that we went to a while ago called Taste Philadelphia, where I picked up this little brandy that is infused with pawpaw liqueur. It's a special bottle that reminds me a lot of cachaça in the sense that it tastes like ripe fruit, which I really, really appreciate. And just like thinking about the pawpaw just brings up some really nice memories from early on in my professional career that I look back on too fondly. It tastes really good and would probably go well as a substitute for cachaça in such drinks as a caipirinha, or there was a drink that I learned recently from a podcast I watched and I don't remember what that drink was called, but it also used cachaça. So I don't remember what that was, but alas, it is beyond me. And so we found ourselves going from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, down to Hilton Head Island, South Carolina, up to Indianapolis, Indiana, and then back to Philadelphia, where we have come here, back to the BarWithAnX, with plenty more bottles to choose from and a bunch more experimentation going ahead. I see RS Kel popping in with a couple of those hearts there. I was just reflecting fondly upon the vacation that we got to share with y'all. And it's getting pretty late over here, and I am totally done. So let's make our way over to the end. That is all that I have for you beautiful, beautiful people of the world. And I thank you very greatly for sitting around for my random vamping and whatnot of the different spirits and bottles that we were able to find on our way. Ultimately, that was such a freaking fun trip. And I had so, so much fun to it. I love the road trip aspect of it. I love the tourism aspect of it. Sipping the little flavors of the local area and stuff. And of course, when you're around good people, of course it's going to be a good time. It was great. Been watching for a while, says RS Calv. I love you. Thanks, Mom. I love you very much too. And thanks for making the piece of that journey very, very special for me as well. Well, to everybody out there, thank you so much for joining along until the bitter end. I greatly appreciate your presence here. And now that I am back at the BarWithAnX, the party will continue until morale improves next Wednesday at 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern Standard Time, where we will be doing something completely different. We've been doing a lot of I think in the background, not that it's very obvious to everybody else, but I've been doing a little bit more content research recently, and I want to hopefully say, with great hope and great fervor in mind, that there are some good things coming, I hope. Maybe that reflects positively, I don't really know, but I've got some things on my mind that if you stick around for a little longer, you could be a part of it too, which would be an honor for us and for everybody else in our community thus far. Thanks very much for joining us along. I'll see you guys next Wednesday. Until then, if the moon is shining where you are, I hope you have a wonderful rest of your night and evening. If the sun is shining up where you are, may the morning of your day spark you very well. Maybe you've got a cup of coffee, maybe you've got a cup of tea, maybe you've got a bottle of whiskey sitting there for you to get your day started. However the way that you do it, I hope it is a wonderful one. Dawn, afternoon, twilight, whatever. Folks, it is great to be back. And thank you very much. Until next time, y'all. Cheers. And bye.